hallelujah. Girl, sit your hallelujah. Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Saturday night and we in the spot.
Don't believe me, just watch. Some nigga in it.
Take a sip, sign the check.
Julio, get the stretch.
Right to Harlem, Hollywood, Jackson, Mississippi. If we show up, we gon' show out. Smoother than a fresh drop skipping.
I'm too hot. Call the police and the firemen. I'm too hot. Make a dragon wanna retire, man. I'm too hot. Bitch, say my name, you know. Hit you hallelujah. Girls hit you hallelujah. Girls hit you hallelujah. Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you.
Saturday night and we in the spot.
Don't believe me, just watch. Uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up. I said uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up, uptown funk you up. Come on, dance, jump on it. If you suck, said and flown it, if you freak dead and own it, don't brag about it, come show me. Come on, dance. Jump on it if you've succeeded and flown it.
Well, it's Saturday night and we in the spot.
Don't believe me, just watch. Come on. Don't believe me, just watch. 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 Don't believe me, just watch.
Good morning. During yesterday's morning session, Dr. Maddox gave us the late breaking news that the Notre Dame was ablaze. And this morning we hear that remarkably, a fair bit of the structure and the artifacts were preserved. That was only through the rapid response of highly skilled emergency providers like those people in the room. So thank you for what you do every day. Good morning and welcome to day number two. I'm Andrew Bernard. I'm your moderator for the morning session. This is session seven, critical care and trauma treatment. Please go to the session in your navigator and be prepared to submit questions. Our first speaker today really requires no introduction. You know Alison Wilson. She's professor and SKU's family chair of trauma at West Virginia University. She'll tell us about the impact of rapid response teams. Alison.
Thank you, and thank you for allowing me to be back again. So last night we were having dinner as faculty, and I said, I'm giving the first talk, and they said, what on? And I said, rapid response teams. And my dear colleague, who I love and am very close to, but who sometimes is opinionated, Dr. Schreiber, went, ugh, did you like pick that or what? And actually, yes, I did. So I would say perhaps he does not really like this topic. But I would argue that there's a lot of discussion about, are RTs helpful, not helpful? The data says this, the data says that. And as we go through this, and I'm talking to you about some data, I'm going to show you some of the caveats about why some of those papers, particularly meta-analysis, may be significantly flawed. And that these can be just as tailored as, you know, what kind of Easter egg colors do you like, right? So it's very hard at times to say, you know, well, this is the absolute on this topic. And yes, it is true that in many overviews, there's not a huge mortality difference, but there is a big difference in some of the other indicators, which I think you'll agree are still important quality measures and important processes. If you are in your system doing any kind of process improvement, I would ask you to think about how you would handle or what you would do in this particular case, right? So, 76-year-old man with hypertension, diabetes, moderate COPD, but not terrible, presents with sepsis and free air. It's identified. The patient is resuscitated, taken to the operating room, and what they find is that the sigmoid colon is completely exploded. So fecal peritonitis, Hartman's procedure. Family, you know, you go out and you talk with them and you tell the family, hey, it's a touch and go, and you know, we'll see how things go over the next day or so, and it's severe sepsis, and there's the appropriate crepe and the appropriate, we're very concerned, and we're not sure how it's gonna go for grandpa, right? So over the next 48 hours, you know, you've given him great care, you've gotten great source control, he clears his lactate, and he's off pressors and off the ventilator as well, and his mental status is normal, and his renal function returns to normal, that's great. Ostomy has stayed nice and pink and viable, great. And you talk to the family and the patient, you say, hey, things are looking good, I'm really glad, and we're making progress, and we're gonna get out of the ICU, and everyone's all happy, so yay, you've been the hero. So you go upstairs, and of course, you know, there's an ileus, not surprising, and he gets a little confused, and well, maybe it's delirium, he was septic, he's got lots of high risks for delirium. His respiratory rate goes up a bit, right, and they get an x-ray, it shows some atelectasis, so they respond by putting on BiPAP. And his heart rate goes up some, and, you know, the residents are being very attentive, or the APP, and they, you know, well, we must not have started his home meds, let's give some metoprolol. And then 7 hours later, he codes, right? Because really what we missed was the returning of the sepsis, right? So he's back in the ICU, severely septic. You know, and it's kind of, what the heck? What happened? It happened over 7 hours, right? Well, now you go back and you look at the whole case, and you look at the chart, as we often do in our PI processes. And 48 hours prior, he had some low-grade temps. Never spiked, but low-grade temps. Had a left shift on his white count. The absolute white count was normal, okay, but left shift. Oxygen requirement had gone from, you know, 1 liter oxygen nasal cannula up to 4, but it looked the same, right, because it was the same little hose in his nose. And he had an ileus. Urine output had dropped off a bit, so you're at that day 4 and he's not doing that self-diarrhea, but it was still normal, right? 24 hours before this event, now his white count had bumped, and he has some delirium, which is always, should be a sign. Still has the ileus, right? He's not getting better. He's got tachypnea, which got really labeled as atelectasis, but probably was sepsis. Bumped his creatinine just a little bit. Now it's 1.3, right? And his urine output now has decreased. He's a little oliguric. right? How many times have you seen that story play out? And I would argue that probably in many cases, when you go back and look at the patient who then coded on the floor, that it almost always, not always, there are the out of the blue catastrophic events, but almost always that there's this gradual deterioration over time. And so you'll hear a lot about failure to rescue and the importance of rescue on the floor prior to the severe deterioration and crash, right? And there are multiple different ways that this has been handled. You know, we all like to say we're going to be there taking care of our patients all the time. But the reality is that we're drawn in many places. We have big teams, big services. You're in the operating room. You're in clinic and things, and it can pull you away. So there are many different ways that these teams have been described, but oftentimes the literature gets lumped into one, right? So the rapid response teams, there's the critical care outreach teams, and the medical emergency teams. And many times they all get confused and it's thought of as the same thing, but they're not. They're all a little different with different amounts of resources, different amounts of abilities, and different amounts of costs, right? But for all these systems, there's the afferent way that you deal with this, which is event detection and what triggers the team. And then there's the efferent way, which is the team response and then the interventions. And then in the end, what's really important is to do an evaluation and then how can you continue to improve and refine your team. So these are not the same. Apples and oranges, they can be very, very different. And so the activation, when you look at some of these papers, the way these teams get activated is very different and oftentimes very individualized to those hospitals. It can be done by bedside nurse, it can be done by the family calling, some places even allow the patient to call. But if you think about it, the bedside nurse has to recognize that the problem's happening. And that's sometimes where things are still too late. Because if they recognize something was happening before, a lot of times they get that intervention, right? The compositions of the teams are very different. There are some groups that just have a highly trained ICU nurse or a stat nurse who works with a respiratory therapist. Some also include an APP. Some of these teams, the MET teams, those include a critical care physician, right? That's a high resource, high functioning team, but may cause extra cost and may not be needed for many of these things. So it depends on what the goal is of your team. Now, what are some of the examples of things that you can do to PI and see what the impact is of these teams in your areas? And that's looking at decrease in out-of-ICU arrests, right? So some patients may still arrest, but if you are catching these patients before they deteriorate, or if you decrease the number of cardiac arrests total, well, then that's really good. And can you do some of these interventions and decrease the number of intubations? So I would encourage you, when you read these papers that may say, you know, lots of impact, no impact, look closely at what are the triggering mechanisms, what's the composition of the team, right? Because those can greatly affect then the cost factors as well as what they do. So again, the variable structure. Now in the US, about 75% of the teams when you look are made of the nurse and the respiratory therapist. And they can assess, do things by protocols, but they're working through the primary team. The advantages are this is a much cheaper way to do this, and they're often embedded in other jobs, so you don't have them just sitting around waiting for something to happen. They're also helping with being stat nurses other places in the hospital. And it keeps the primary service in the loop. At the same time, they're limited on what they can do, right? So if they need additional help, they're going to call for backup, and that may introduce a time delay. And then at times, too, sometimes the primary service can be a barrier, right? Because if they're not seeing or comprehending that there's a problem with the patient, then, you know, they just may say no. And in fact, we had at our institution one physician who, like, stood at the door and said, you can't go in and take care of my patient. Interesting, the next day their patient had a cardiac arrest on the floor. So again, variable structures. The COOs are the nurse, RT, and usually an APP or physician, oftentimes a hospitalist. And the medical emergency teams, which are very similar to what we call the code blue teams, are usually either critical care or anesthesia. These also bring the bigger teams too, so pharmacy, et cetera. And this is your highest level of resources brought to the bedside. With no delay, you can immediately get interventions. But if you're finding that you have teams that have to do a lot of high level interventions, I would say perhaps your triggering mechanisms for getting there to get assessed are probably too high and you want to bring that trigger down, right? So look at some of the activation criteria and make sure some of them are objective. So this is one protocol that if you have any one of the following, then that should trigger an activation of the rapid response team. And you can see a lot of these, you know, if you wait, and airway threatened, cardiac arrest, you know, systolic blood pressure less than 90, pulse greater than 140, that patient's still in extremis. So this is another one that they noticed that if a patient met any one of these criteria, there was a 6.8 increase in mortality. So these were the triggers for their system. The pitfall to these is that it still requires a human to recognize these things and to make the call, right? And it still requires them to take the action. And what we find a lot of times is that the nurse on the floor or the bedside is afraid of crying wolf. So they don't want to utilize, well, I think they look bad, but I don't want to call and have a bunch of people come up in case I'm wrong and the patient's okay. Sometimes it's a lack of awareness of resources. Sometimes it's a lack of knowledge of how to activate, so not knowing what to do. And sometimes it's a lack of perception that, hey, what I'm really seeing isn't true, indeed, is abnormal. And how does this happen? Well, a lot of times our brains fill in what makes the picture look right, you know? So we tend to rationalize, well, he was a little confused yesterday, so maybe this is just the same thing. Maybe there's a lack of awareness. Maybe they're pulled in different directions. Maybe they're having to spend so much time charting in the damn EMR that they can't even take time to go look at the patient, right? Sometimes it's inexperience and they don't know how to synthesize the data. And sometimes they just don't see the problem, like this guy holding that big yummy fish with the grizzly bear who's about to eat him, right? So another way you can do this is to combine it with an auto trigger. So what we did was we worked within our computer system. How many of you have Epic? A lot of people have Epic? Yeah. So what I did not know, and you may not know, is that the Epic runs the Muse score in the background all the time. You just have to ask your IT people to bring it up and bring it toward the front so you can see it. But this is happening all the time in the background anyway. And it's based on a system that extracts respiration, pulse, and it brings out a score, and that actually can auto-generate a call, right? So when the Muse score hits a number, you can plug it in and set it so that that sends a page to certain people and activate your team. So now you're not relying on somebody to know that something's happened. So this is an example of the Muse score. Shows you that the farther away you get from normal, it will pick things up, right? So multiple small subtle changes or one significant big change will then get you from a green to a yellow or to a red, right? So, and the way we set it up so that we could see it is then if you click on the patient's chart, it will show you where the abnormalities are. So on your way to see the patient, you can see, oh, pulse is up, temperature's up, respirations are up. And you can actually have them custom build a thing so you can also look at what we thought were our key information, what was the last white count, hemoglobin, potassium, to give our team some of that really important information right up front before they even get up there. So outcomes in this particular paper showed a decrease of respiratory failure by over 79% in post-op patients, decreased stroke, decreased severe sepsis, decreased renal failure. Other papers have shown, you know, decreased 38% decrease of cardiac arrest. Well, that's a pretty important thing, right? Decrease in the unplanned returns to the ICU and post-op complications. Many, many, many studies that show decrease in out of ICU arrests, you know, decrease in readmissions, and some that show decreases in mortalities, but those tend to be single institution. There was one randomized study that was done with an MET that showed no change in mortality. But remember, the MET is that highest, it's essentially like a code team that brings a critical care physician. And so some of their triggers were a little higher level. I would argue a very, very low, high sensitivity, low specificity triggering mechanism, and then getting some kind of resource up there to help and evaluate is the most helpful. In our place, what we found was a reduction of the code blues consistently by 15%, despite increasing our total number of beds by 110 beds. And if you look what's happened with our team, and you can see the number of times they were able to do bedside care, go ahead and do an intervention, and then move them to a step down or an ICU, and then times where they've upgraded. They've gotten there and said, no, we need more help, and they still call the code team, right? And then there were also some times that, this was when we first launched this, and there were just some times in which, because it's some auto-triggering from charting, that we found there were documentation errors. And let me tell you, this number's dramatically decreased. So it's actually helped with some of our charting because people don't want to have this team show up when indeed it was just that they didn't chart the urine output or something. So, PI, what do we do with this information? So we look at how long they're staying in the rooms. And if they're in a room greater than an hour, our question is why? And that's given us some insight into how long does it take to get a patient to an ICU? Or do we have some barriers with our primary teams? These are other indicators that we use to look at how are we doing house-wide, right? Do they spend more than an hour? Is there a code within 24 hours of an RRT where they did not upgrade their care? Or was there a problem with the primary service? I will tell you one thing, when we look house-wide and we compare a year ago before we had this team and we compare now, and you look at the patients that are in that abnormal MU score area that are not in an ICU, we saw a reduction of patients with those scores in the red by over 700%. 700% decrease in patients that had extraordinary deranges in their physiology that were not in an ICU environment, despite having 110 more beds, right? So to me, what that means is we're paying attention, intervening more, and getting them to a right level of care. So here's the summary. Use clinical judgment as well as objective criteria. Don't wait till they arrest. And then use the team for what you need. And then really look carefully at this data before you say yay or nay on if it's going to be helpful. Thank you very much.
Hey, this is working. Okay. Thank you, Alison. Our next speaker is David Zonies. He's Associate Professor of Surgery at OHSU. He's their Trauma Director, and he's Director of their ECMO program. He'll talk about ECMO this morning and whether we should all get on board. Morning, David.
Morning. Thanks. Good morning. So to answer the question, should we all get on board? The answer is obviously yes. And I have no disclosures. So about 6-8 months ago, a 24-year-old male riding a motorcycle crashed, was brought into our hospital, and you saw that at previous x-ray. Within 12 hours, you know, he was admitted to our intensive care unit for pulmonary toilet, pain control for his multiple rib fractures. He had a very, very small brain injury, and he developed profound hypoxic respiratory failure within 12 hours. He went from being on a 2-liter non-nasal cannula to being intubated on 100% FiO2 and was dying in front of us. Our team was activated with an ECMO consultation. He was placed on support in our ICU. What that brought us was ECMO, and ECMO is basically time at a price. And what ECMO is there to do is to help support your patient to some bridge, to some type of definitive care. 47 years ago, the first adult was placed on ECMO. That patient was a trauma patient, a 24-year-old male who was in a motorcycle crash in Santa Barbara. It's pretty much the same story. In the foreground of that picture there is the Bramson lung. That was the predecessor to what we now consider ECMO. This is veno arterial ECMO. He was, after he was had all of his surgical injuries repaired, his traumatic injuries repaired, he developed severe ARDS, and around day 5 or 6, they called down a team from Irvine and placed him on this experimental therapy. He, you can see here, this is just a graph of his arterial blood gas, and over the next several days made a rapid recovery. He ultimately was discharged neurologically intact. And the question really was, did he survive because he was 24 and just needed time, or was it because of this intervention? This generated a lot of discussion and a lot of interest, which led to a randomized controlled trial 3 years later. Unfortunately, the survival was 10% in both the ECMO arm and the conventional arm. So it was decided, at least in ECMO, it was not really feasible. This was probably a one-off. About a decade later, Luciano Gattinoni went at it again, this time using a low-frequency positive pressure ventilation strategy with ECMO versus conventional therapy. And again, this is in the days of 10 to 12 ml per kilo tidal volumes. In that case, the overall group, 50% survival in both arms. And the third bar to the right is the trauma group, and they had an 80% mortality. So at least in trauma patients, we were some of the worst performers. Again, in the 80s, ECMO was not ready for prime time. It was shelved. But we tried again in the 90s because we were persistent. And this was a study out of Salt Lake City. This was ended early, 38% survival in both arms. The trial was stopped. ECMO is not feasible. Well, what happened? 2009, you can see that there's been an inflection point. There's been this logarithmic increase in the number of ECMO patients and ECMO centers. 80% of the cases in the registry have all been put in since 2009. Overall hospital survival, 60%. So what happened? Well, if you look to see where those patients are, in 2018, I want to point your attention to the blue and the red bars. The largest proportion of patients on ECMO are not children any longer. It is adults for cardiac and adults for pulmonary failure. Well, 2009, we had H1N1. There was a great response in Australia and New Zealand for patients who were actively dying and were placed on ECMO because there were no other options. And they actually had about an 80% survivability. This was repeated in the UK, same thing, about an 80% survival. Same year, the CSER trial was released. This is the first randomized controlled trial to show both a mortality benefit with a 21% relative risk reduction of dying if you were randomized to the ECMO arm, and because this was an NHS study out of the UK, they needed costs to surround it. It was also shown at 6 months to be cost effective with a reduction in disability adjusted life years. This was the trial that we were all waiting for. Well, there were some problems with the trial. The protocol was not exactly uniform. They weren't using the most recent technology, and so there was a lot of criticism around this trial, but it was a good trial. It was followed up by the EOLA trial, which was released last year in the New England Journal. This trial was actually stopped early because they were not going to get to their destination point. And I would say that this was the most positive, negative trial that we've had. So there's a lot of people who just don't believe in it, and they point to the EOLA trial, and there's others who say, you know what, there's a signal there. And so there are going to be some subgroup analyses to look at this trial to see if we had extended it, would there have been a signal of difference? So what else changed? Generation 1 of ECMO is what you see on the left side of the screen. Very complicated, essentially taking the cardiopulmonary bypass system out of the operating room and putting it into the intensive care unit. You need a perfusionist. You need intensivists. It's very, very complicated. Miniaturization of the technology, ease of use, the ability to bond heparin to the plastic cannulas to reduce the risk of thrombosis, all happened in the late 2000s. We also moved from needing a perfusionist to being able to have a nurse be at the bedside. The current system we have is the size of a shoebox. So what is ECMO and extracorporeal life support? Well, it really just depends where you put the catheter and where you put the oxygenator. So it could be for respiratory failure, which is VV support, VA support for cardiogenic shock. There are extended uses for ECMO-supported donation after cardiac death, mostly in Western Europe, ECMO-supported CPR, CO2 removal to avoid the ventilator for patients who have severe COPD. There are many applications. It really just depends what your indication is and where you put your catheter. When we created our team, the secondary benefit was just not that you could do ECMO or not do ECMO, but we provided another view of the patient, and we were basically consultants who could give some advice, and even if they weren't an ECMO candidate, we were just another set of eyes on the patient. The first question I always ask when I get consulted is, well, what's your destination? What's this bridge? And if your bridge is to nowhere, then they are not going to be a candidate. You have to have a destination, and whether that destination is just a reversal of the underlying pathology, or you've got a destination to a ventricular assist device or to lung transplant, you have to have that in your mind. And so what are the indications for cardiac support, VA ECMO? It's pretty straightforward. It's cardiogenic shock. There are certainly some contraindications to ECMO, and there's a long list, and you can find these on any of the websites. These are pretty traditional. Essentially, if you're not a VAD candidate, you're not a transplant candidate, and or you have a terminal malignancy, we probably shouldn't put you on a support therapy that doesn't lead to anywhere. For respiratory failure, which is the majority of what you're going to see in trauma patients, once you get beyond lung protective strategies, once you get beyond neuromuscular blockade, proning patients, this should be in the toolbox, and it's what we're looking at is severe ARDS. For VV support, you have to have a risk of dying greater than 50% is traditionally what we look at, and that's going to be your patients with severe ARDS anyway. We'll often use the Murray score, which is sort of a combination of your FiO2, your lung compliance, your P to F ratio, and your PEEP. And if you're on more than 90% oxygen and you've got a Murray score of 2 to 3, then you're a candidate. And if you've been on for more than 6 hours and you are really not making any progress, you're also a candidate. There are not really absolute contraindications for VV support. We used to say there were many of them, including trauma, but that has all gone away, and I'll show you why. However, if you've been on a vent for 7 to 10 days, ECMO is not going to help you. If you, and that's usually one of our contraindications, is if you've already been doing all this therapy and you didn't call us early, if you're on ECMO or you're not on ECMO, your likelihood of dying is very high. There are scoring systems out there. This is the RESP score. It's an app on your phone. When we go to talk to patients and families, we'll pull this up so we at least have some data to show what their risk of mortality is with or without support. There are several of these calculators that are out there. I also go with the data from the registry. So the registry looks at both, do you survive your ECMO run, and actually do you get out of the hospital alive? And those are the numbers that we need to show both the teams and the patients' families. And so for respiratory failure, it's about a 60% discharge rate. For cardiac, a bit less, and ECPR, which is still an emerging area, is about 30%, which quite honestly is pretty impressive considering what CPR outcomes are without ECMO. It has now moved to being an out of operating room procedure. This is our intensive care unit. We place them percutaneously with the ECMO nurse, and I'm having a fellow place a cannula here with me. It's very straightforward. We can get a patient on support in 20 to 30 minutes. If you go back about 25 years, the data specifically for trauma patients has been kind of all over the place, but it's somewhere between 40 and 80%. Some of the traditional contraindications was, one, if you've got a coagulopathic trauma patient, you probably shouldn't put them on support when you need to anticoagulate them. Well, one, we're getting better, and you've heard over the last day and a half, that our resuscitation with whole blood, our overall hemostatic resuscitation is so much better than it had been in the past. This has really not been an issue for us. We will often run patients, if they are coagulopathic, without heparin. You just don't anticoagulate them, often for their entire run, and they do just fine, and the oxygenator doesn't clot. How about brain injury? Traditionally, it's been a contraindication. Well, this study out of North Germany, out of Hamburg, Ralph Muhlenbach, started to put patients on support with active traumatic brain injuries and when they had severe ARDS. You just don't run them with an anticoagulant, and that's what our protocol is. Once they get a stable head CT, you can start prophylaxis, and typically within 4 to 5 days, when you feel that the patient's stable, you can start full-dose anticoagulation. Outcomes are excellent. A few years ago, a group of us looked at the entire ELSA registry, and we pulled out all the trauma patients. There's about 273 that have been in the registry since the late 80s. You can see almost all of them have been put into the registry in the last 5 years because the technology's gotten so much better, and our experience has gotten better. So what trauma patients are put in? Well, traditionally, it's going to be for severe ARDS and typically thoracic injury, but you can see there's a whole host of primary indications for why these patients went on to support. When you move from initial pre-ECMO to ECMO within 24 hours, you can see that the FiO2, we can drop from 100% to 50%. We drop their PEEP, we drop their mean airway pressure, and we basically take the lungs out of the picture and allow them to the time that they need to recover. So how do they recover? About 70% of patients are ultimately going to have native lung recovery, at least among trauma patients. About 15% go on to multi-organ failure, and this is consistent with what we see in other patient populations. Overall, if you compare us, trauma patients, to the ELSA registry, trauma patients outperform the registry for all comers, for both respiratory failure, cardiac failure, ECPR, we're not doing so well, but typically these patients, the indications for putting them on are a bit questionable. But you can see here, we've taken patients to the operating room. This is a colectomy being performed for a patient who needed urgent surgery and also was developing ARDS. This is a non-trauma patient. But it's mobile. We can take it all over the hospital. We fly patients on helicopters. It's pretty straightforward. So how many people are doing this, and what do the centers look like? So in North America, if you look at the median number of patients per ECMO center, it's 15. But if you look at the range, most centers are small, 5 patients or 5 to 10 patients. So there are outliers like the big university hospitals, but in general, most centers don't do a whole lot of ECMO. This was the reason why a white paper was put out about 5 years ago, which looked at how you should staff, what the indications are. If you're going to start a program, I recommend this, and this is in the syllabus, this reference, about what you need to get started and what your program should look like. It's an excellent reference paper. Ryan Barbaro then looked at how many cases you need to be competent, and this is a very controversial area, but we think it's probably between 20 to 30 cases a year per center to maintain clinical competency that you have much better outcomes. At least that's the early signal that we see. We don't know a whole lot about the trauma population. The ELSA registry, when it was created, was never intended to look at trauma patients. So the data that we have is the data that's been in the registry. Last year, a small group of us were able to get the registry to accept an addendum. And that addendum is going to basically pull data from traditional trauma registries, from TQIP, into the ELSA registry as an addenda so that we can specifically look at trauma patients. We can look at blood transfusion practices. We can look at timing to the operating room. We can look at all the post-surgical complications that are not currently in the registry. And we hope to be able to refine the patient population that really should be placed on ECMO support and provide better outcomes. Just to summarize, I think this is the golden age of ECMO support. I think it's finally here. It's here to stay. There are more centers. We're getting better at figuring out the indications of who the best patients are to be put on support, but there are still many, many questions out there like nutritional support, early mobilization, and the use of various drugs when your volume of distribution is altered by having an extracorporeal circuit. But ECMO, I believe, is probably going to go in the same direction that renal replacement has gone and other advanced therapies in the ICU, that most centers are going to be able to take this on. Thank you.
Thanks, David, for that great overview and update. Our next speaker is Mark Kaplan. He's professor and chair of trauma and surgical critical care at Einstein in Philadelphia. He'll try to help us find some sanity and antibiotics in the ICU. Mark.
Thanks. Good morning. I'd like to thank Dr. Maddox and Mary for inviting me back. It's always a tremendous honor to be here. So my assignment was to talk about antibiotic sanity and insanity in the intensive care unit. So first, there's no disclosures except I use antibiotics. And the second is, first I want to go over some urban legends of antibiotics, and we do this every day. Antibiotics are safe. A patient has a fever and a white count, there's no source, so better put them on antibiotics just to be safe. If I treat this infection with antibiotics, I won't have to operate. I think one of the biggest ones now are treatment of appendicitis. This person absolutely needs 10 days of antibiotics, even with clinical improvement, because I'm going to get bacterial resistance. Only clindamycin causes C. diff, and patients die from bacterial infection if not treated. Some of the other urban legends are sepsis is well-defined and a good indicator for the treatment of bacterial infection, that white count, temperature are the best way to monitor treatment, and the body's immune system is not capable of handling infections and needs antibiotics for survival. And the rest of this talk is going to be to knock down all those concepts. So first of all, antibiotics do play a role. You know, they're integral in what we're doing every day. It has increased life expectancy and survival in the ICU. Surviving sepsis guidelines that have been revised all clearly state that early administration of antibiotics is an integral part of treating somebody with sepsis. And there's data that clearly shows that for each hour that you delay with the bacterial infection, it increases the mortality rate. And again, empiric multimodality therapy has been used multiple times and is an important component in our treatment of infections. However, antibiotic use in the ICU has been based on the identification of severely septic patients and patients that are dying. But if you really look at those criteria, okay, signs and steps of infection are really poorly defined and can be confused with non-infectious inflammatory states in the intensive care unit. Like 30 to 60% of antibiotics in the ICU are completely unnecessary and have been added because we think the patient is septic, but they're really not with a bacterial infection. And again, misprescribing of antibiotics is probably one of the significant causes of emergent resistant bacteria in the intensive care unit. So we have this habit, and the habit is, let's just start antibiotics just in case we need them because he might have an infection. Well, they're not safe, and there's a significant amount of data that's been shown now that 1 in 5 patients will have at least one antibiotic-associated drug event, and 97% of those are considered significant. I think what's interesting is that for every 10 days of antibiotic therapy in the intensive care unit, there's a 3% increase in adverse reactions. 42% happen to be GI symptoms, probably related more to C. diff. So antibiotics are not really safe. Again, this is what's, when Dr. Maddox asked me to look at this topic, this is something I really thought about for a long time. You know, the use of antibiotics is based on the clinical syndrome of sepsis. Sepsis guidelines were developed when to start antibiotics. But it's a flawed methodology. And the reason why that is because virtually every patient with signs of sepsis is started on antibiotics. But there's a dilemma, because a delay in starting antibiotics with infection increases mortality, but inappropriate use of antibiotics in the intensive care unit also increases mortality. A lot of times, antibiotics are used as a last resort and as a desperate attempt to save a patient. And a lot of times, those patients don't even have a septic source, which will then increase complications even more. So there's a biologic context that is really difficult to understand. And sepsis is dichotomous. It can be seen in a non-infected patient. It can be seen in an infected patient. And it's really this lack of recognition that death is generally related to the inflammatory state and usually had nothing to do with the infection that started the process in the first place. This leads to prolonged use of antibiotics, even when the organism has been eradicated, and leads to adverse effects on the immune system and increases complications with resistant organisms. So this is something we really need to think about when we start throwing antibiotics at patients. Antibiotic resistance is one of the big problems. Fleming, who invented penicillin in his first papers, recognized the potential for resistance, and his wife happened to die from a resistant strain of penicillin from a leg infection. It's a global health crisis now, and it's found in all microbial classes and is usually caused by overuse of antibiotics, the natural evolution of bacteria and how they grow, and lack of effective control. This is really interesting. 80% of the food that we eat have antibiotics in it, okay? This will definitely lead to antibiotic resistance. And Europe has banned antibiotics in foods. We have not. Again, antibiotic resistance is accelerating. In the past, pharmaceutical companies have really risen to develop new drugs for resistance. However, 15 out of 18 pharmaceutical companies have left the antibiotic business due to regulatory problems and actual money for developing these things, which is leading to a near global crisis as far as antibiotic resistance. Now, this is really an important take-home message. Patients that develop resistant organisms because of ineffective treatment or delays or recurrent infection, they have a significant increase in mortality. And it's expensive. Patients with resistant organisms will cost somewhere between $18,000 to $29,000 per patient, and there's some hospital systems that can cost probably over $15 million a year, and multiply that by all the numbers, all the hospitals in the country, that's a big health crisis, and it's costing a lot of money. The other thing, antibiotics are not as effective as we think, okay? Pharmacokinetics have a significant effect on tissue levels with ineffective therapy. Antibiotics work in the interstitial fluid and in the plasma, and don't necessarily penetrate into the interstitial areas where the bacteria is. So their effectiveness is only estimated. Critically ill patients have microvascular collapse, therefore limits their penetration of antibiotics. Obesity, along with other things, has a significant effect on unpredictable fat distribution, and there's also a decrease in binding proteins. If you don't have binding proteins, the antibiotics can't make it to the tissue in the first place. There's also this other assumption that broad-spectrum antibiotics will eventually eliminate an organism. But there's really a lack of understanding, and what we don't seem to understand is that by using antibiotics, we can also lead to a significant decrease in defense mechanisms. So the more logical question is not when an inflammatory state's in response to an infection, How subtle is it, and how often do we have to keep the antibiotics going based on the inflammatory state, not necessarily due to the bacteria? So I think there's a better way to describe an infection, an ongoing infection in somebody who appears to be septic, is really a non-resolving organ dysfunction syndrome that really is exacerbated by antibiotic use and not abated by antibiotic use. Effects on the immune system. Antibiotics have a significant effect on the immune system. We're just starting to learn. There are many times there's an ongoing septic picture long after the organism is gone, but we continue to keep pumping them with antibiotics. So a lot of times, again, as I said before, a lot of patients don't die from the infection. They die from the inflammatory state that's only exacerbated by the antibiotics. Let me talk about the microbiome. I'm not a representative from GNC, so... But the microbiome is probably one of the most important topics that we need to understand as surgeons, and especially in critical care. It really is the key to maintaining good health, and we destroy it by giving them antibiotics over a long period of time. The microbiome is really important for wound healing, protein synthesis, neuroendocrine function, even mental health. It's not just they're going to give them diarrhea. Functions of the microbiome include a healthy immune system, protection from pathologic invasion, synthesis of key molecules. The antibiotics will alter the microbiome even after one dose of antibiotics. And this alteration can last for months and is one of the main reasons why patients don't recover as well as they should, especially from an intensive care unit where they've gotten high doses of antibiotics. Prolonged antibiotics use, again, will disrupt the microbiota, and there's this whole new syndrome of called dysbiosis, which I think we need to pay attention to. I think it's very important because this probably leads to the SIRS and the inflammatory state that we see in these patients when they've been exposed to antibiotics much too long. C. diff, we know, is a problem. It's due to just about antibiotic. Fluoroquinolone, Cipro now, is probably one of the major reasons why people are getting C. diff. We don't use Cipro anymore in the intensive care unit. You've got to pay very attention to that. We do use antibiotics and regulating class of antibiotics. Marty, thank you for the yogurt, which has been a little hard to get in, but we've been using probiotics on everybody that's in antibiotics in the intensive care unit. Fecal transplant is still fascinating. Surgical source control. This is one of the keys in managing infections. It's not antibiotics. Source control is the key to handling infections, especially surgical infections. Local host response will recruit inflammatory cells. The result is this blockage, as you can see in that upper picture. And antibiotics in this scenario only control the systemic effects, but will not get any local control. There's a creation of the biofilm that we all have to be aware of. This is a protective microcalyx that forms in an infection that prevents antibiotics from getting to the source. So it's an environmental protector. You must control the biofilm if you're going to control an infection, not antibiotics. The treatment of biofilm, we like to use a debrider for that. You can see that in the middle is the formation of the biofilm. And not only does the biofilm prevent antibiotics from getting into the organism, it actually causes necrosis and exudate that you see at the surface. So antibiotics are not going to work. Constant debridement is going to work. Antibiotics only work for the systemic effects in the first 24 to 48 hours. Source control, as I said, includes debridement. Source control is needed to prevent continued contamination and to overcome the local defense mechanisms of bacteria. And also, you minimize the amount of exposure to antibiotics. Just briefly, the duration of antibiotics, as we know, this has really changed recently with a lot of prospective studies. Traditionally, patients were on antibiotics for 10 to 14 days. Prospective studies have shown it to be completely ineffective. Short courses of therapy for probably 4 days were appropriate with the appropriate source control. It's very clear from the data that reduction in the amount of or the time that patients are on antibiotics does reduce morbidity and mortality. Now, what's interesting is prolonged use of antibiotics will not only increase the amount of mortality, but also increase extra-abdominal infections as well. Successful treatment of intra-abdominal infection is a combination of source control and just 4 days of antibiotics. And continued therapy will only make it worse. Biomarkers, just briefly, it's come into the picture, procalcitonin. at one time was thought to be an effective way to look at bacterial infection. I need to emphasize the fact that all those studies have been done in pneumonia and not intra-abdominal infection. It has limited use in trauma patients because trauma patients have cytokines are flying around all over the place. So it may be effective for your patient 10 days down the line with pneumonia, but right now it has not really been effective in patients with traumatic injuries. Again, antibiotic resistance is probably the big cause of all our problems. I can only emphasize that each intensive care unit should have its own antibiotic stewardship. And it has three obstacles. Complex decision-making is sometimes altered with when to place patients on antibiotics, difficulties in the continuity of care, and inconsistencies in delaying identifying CHU infection versus just overall sepsis and inflammation. Again, rapid identification of patients who are potentially infected should include antibiotics. However, stopping them should also be done very rapidly when there's no evidence of an infection. We use an antibiogram, I'm sure everybody in our hospital does, which will actually allow us to pick out the appropriate antibiotics and the appropriate resistance and will really minimize the amount of complications with antibiotics if you use this. But an antibiotic stewardship is really essential in minimizing the amount, not only of the use of antibiotics, but also cutting down on resistance in the ICU. So getting back to the talk, sanity and sanity of antibiotic use. Yeah, there is sanity, of course. Antibiotics have a limited role in the management of bacterial infections. Antibiotic stewardship program is imperative when you use it, and source control combined with antibiotics is important. But the insanity, and this is where we're really getting ourselves into trouble, are antibiotics are not a substitute for good surgical care. Assumption is that antibiotics are safe is completely wrong, and the indiscriminate use of antibiotics is really important. Now, so Dedrician and Matt started last year, the most important slide of the talk. Antibiotics are not safe. Short courses of therapy are important. Most people do not die from infection, but will usually die from the inflammatory response exacerbated by the antibiotics. Antibiotic resistance is mostly man-made, and your body's defense system, which has been developing over the past million years, needs to allow to do its job. Good surgical care is the key to antibiotics. And unfortunately, people still have this impression of antibiotics and a lot of times have their head in the sand. Made it.
Thanks a lot, Mark. Our next speaker is Carlos Brown. He is professor and chief of acute care surgery at UT in Austin. He'll talk about fungal infections in the ICU. Carlos.
Thanks, Andrew. I want to thank Dr. Maddox and Mary for inviting me back to this awesome conference. Great to be here with you all this morning. We're going to continue the theme of surgical infections, change a little bit to fungal infections. I have nothing to disclose. So the objectives today are to talk about the epidemiology of fungal infections, risk factors, the diagnosis, and the treatment. So we're going to talk specifically about invasive fungal infections with two organisms, the Candida species as well as aspergillosis. Now, Candida species is ubiquitous. It's all over your body. It's all over everything that we interact with every day, your skin, your respiratory mucosa, urinary mucosa. It's everywhere. But however, in certain situations, Candida can become an invasive species in nature. And the two invasive types of Candida infections we're going to talk about are candidemia, or Candida growing in the blood, and a deep organ space infection in a space that's typically sterile. So if you look at how Candida interacts with us and how it gets causes an infection, you talk about the Candida that colonizes the gut, you get a perforation or an anastomotic leak, that Candida now becomes a pathogen, can cause an invasive candidal infection. Similarly, when you're placing a venous catheter, arterial catheter, you cross the skin, which is covered in Candida, that Candida goes down the catheter, forms biofilm, and again can become candidemia or invasive infection. And though Candida is typically seen in the urine, and is typically not treated, it can become an ascending infection and cause pyelonephritis or even a nephric abscess. This is the same for all other body systems, the spleen, the liver, the eye, the lungs, and the bones and the spine. And so, though it's everywhere in the body, it can become invasive depending on the situation. Now, we're going to talk mostly about Canada albicans. There's a whole slew of Canada species, dozens, literally dozens of them, can't cover them all. Mostly we'll talk about Canada albicans. However, there's a few specific Canada species that are worth talking about. Canada glabrata is going to be seen in older patients, specifically transplant patients. Canada parasilosis, post-surgical patients and patients with vascular catheters. Candida krusei, younger patients with cancer, neutropenia, and steroids. And then Candida tropicalis, less common and more virulent. And you just heard about antibiograms and your local pattern of resistance and bugs. This is really something to look at when you get home. What Candida species grow at your institution? Now, invasive candidiasis is uncommon, 2 to 14 cases per 100,000 people. It occurs in the extremes of age. However, it's quite lethal with a 20 to 40% mortality in critically ill patients. Risk factors for Candida is about what you would expect for invasive candidiasis: colonization, which is basically everybody, critical illness, a prolonged ICU stay, an abdominal surgery, specifically with anastomotic leak or GI perforation, severe pancreatitis, the placement of vascular catheters with TPN. You think of just putting sugar and fat through a plastic line going into your blood. That's going to be a risk factor. Antibiotics and prolonged antibiotics, hemodialysis, malignancy, and chemotherapy. So basically really sick ICU patients are going to be at risk to develop invasive candidiasis. There is an immunogenetic component to it as well. Some patients with little or no risk factors will develop invasive candidiasis. If you're interested in some light reading, there's actually an entire textbook devoted to immunogenetics of fungal diseases. So what about the diagnosis of invasive candidiasis? Well, this can be done either directly or indirectly. The direct method is not great. Neither one of these is actually great, and there's no perfect way to diagnose it. And it's kind of strange to have a disease that has a mortality rate of 40% that's hard to diagnose, but this falls in that category. So the direct diagnosis is growing it in culture. You culture out the Candida species when you're working the patient up. It's only about 20 to 70% sensitive, so you have patients who have invasive candidiasis and don't culture it out when you're working them up, so that's a pretty dangerous situation. However, it's 100% specific in the blood. If you grow Candida in the blood, that is an invasive candidal infection by definition. It's in the sterile spaces, the question is it infection or is it colonization? And so again, if you grow it in the urine and grow it in the sputum, you typically don't treat that. You consider that colonization. However, patients can develop invasive candidiasis in the chest cavity, in the urinary system. It's a slow turnaround time. This takes about 2 to 4 days to get the results back for these cultures. And they may not grow a positive culture until late in their course. And so when to treat and how to treat becomes a challenge. There's two methods for indirect diagnosis. The beta-D glucan is one method. It's a highly sensitive but species dependent. Its power is in the negative predictive value. If your beta-D glucan is negative, you do not have an invasive candidal infection. It's a short turnaround time, a matter of hours. However, you may have to send it out of your hospital to a special lab. Low specificity, a lot of false positives with other infections, antibiotics, transfusion, and so on. So really, the beta-D glucan is really, you want it for negative predictive value. Polymerase chain reaction, very, very sensitive, very specific, short turnaround time, a matter of hours. However, when I was reading about this, there's really no consensus on how to use it and how to standardize it. Treatment, early presumptive antifungal therapy. So antifungals to treat it, but source control is really is the mainstay of treatment. Remove that catheter. This is not a catheter to limp through an infection. If they have a candida in the blood, you get the catheter out. And then deep space drainage, wherever that is in the body, you get that infection out of that patient as well. Options for early presumptive antifungal therapy, there's azoles, echinocandins, and amphotericin. The azoles are the ones we talk about most often, specifically fluconazole, which can be given IV or PO. Echinocandins, mycofungin, caspofungin, and anadolafungin are options. And then amphotericin B, which was the main treatment for many, many years, both in its regular form and the liposomal form, which is going to have less nephrotoxicity. So what's your choice? How do you make that decision which antifungal to use? Well, there's been a lot of studies comparing one antifungal to another, specifically early on to amphotericin, and then later on comparing the echinocandins to fluconazole. And really, they're just different. Most of these studies were done as non-inferiority studies, so it's hard to say one is better than the other. They're just different options you can have to treat these patients. The one study compared anadolafungin to fluconazole, and it found actually a mortality, a treatment success rate and a mortality rate improved with anadolafungin, which sort of changed the echinocandins to first-line therapy. So the kind of candidates, again, are going to be first-line therapy, both sick and not sick patients. So it doesn't have to be really sick patients, specifically with for albicans and glabrata. So go home and look at your antibiogram. If you grow a lot of albicans, a lot of glabrata, you might want to consider using echinocandins as your first line. And then candidemia, definitely first line therapy for candidemia is going to be echinocandins. Azoles and specifically fluconazole, low-risk patients, antibiogram dependent on what you grow at your institution. Location, meningitis, and UTI, the azoles will be better for these infections. Also for Candida parasilosis. And then if they've been on previous echinocandins historically and now they have a fungal infection, you might have a resistant bug and switch to fluconazole. So your MOC question, I wrote it poorly, and I'm going to revise it for you here. First-line therapeutic agent for candidiasis is, and I expand this question, in a stable ambulatory low-risk patient with local antibiogram that reveals 95% sensitivity to fluconazole. So I've reworded your MOC question. Make sure you get it right, because I wrote it very poorly before. So duration de-escalation. Dr. Kaplan talked a little bit about time. This is one where really you're going to keep these patients on antibiotics for a long time. You're probably going to consult ID as well, which is going to drive that time even longer. So 10 to 14 days after candidemia clears and after resolution of clinical symptoms. So it's a long time, a long duration of therapy, maybe even longer if there's end organ involvement. You can switch to oral fluconazole if you're using azole as your treatment, as the same penetration bioavailability as IV, depending on your susceptibilities. So empiric and prophylactic antifungals, empiric in high-risk patients with persistent fever, hypotension while receiving broad-spectrum antibiotics. So you're suspecting on fungal infection, haven't grown it yet, but you're worried about it, you can start empirically. And then a lot has been written about prophylaxis with not a lot of great answers. Highest risk patients, ICU with high rate of invasive candidiasis, perforations of the GI tract. All it does is decrease invasive candidiasis. It does not improve mortality. It also comes at a price. You get more resistance. On the far left, you see no prophylaxis. It's almost all Candida albicans. You add prophylaxis for less than 7 days, you start growing to Candida krusei. Prophylaxis for greater than 7 days, you see how much less albicans you have, and you have a lot more krusei, a lot more glabrata. So if you prophylax somebody, you're going to start growing resistant non-albicans bugs. What about by antifungal? Again, no prophylaxis in the gray is almost all Candida albicans. You prophylax with fluconazole, you start growing out parasilosis and glabrata. And you start prophylaxing with an echinocandin, caspofungin, almost Candida albicans is almost gone. You'll start growing out again parasilosis and glabrata. So if you choose to prophylax, realize that it's not going to improve mortality. It's going to maybe decrease invasive candidiasis, and you will grow non-albicans resistant bugs in your institution. So what about invasive aspergillosis? We'll change gears a little bit here. So Aspergillus fumigatus is the most common bug. It's airborne, and pulmonary aspergillosis is the most common manifestation as pneumonia, thrombosis, hemorrhage, or necrosis in the lung. The diagnosis is based on risk factors, culture, pathology from sterile sites, and radiography. The risk factors, again, sicker patients, so COPD, malnutrition, diabetes, cirrhosis, patients with the flu, abdominal surgery, and dialysis. Culture or pathology from sterile sites, you don't count a BAL, sinus, or urine as a positive culture. You exclude those. But if you grow it from some other sterile site, that's going to be a positive culture. Again, low sensitivity, similar to growing out Candida. Pathologist-dependent, slow turnaround time. So diagnosis is difficult again. Radiography is much more helpful for Aspergillus than it is for Candida. Chest X-ray or CT scan findings of aspergilloma in the lung, but they lack specificity. So invasive aspergillosis can be either proven, probable, or possible. A proven invasive aspergillosis is if you have risk factors and specimens acquired from a sterile site that show abnormal clinical or radiographic findings that are positive on micro and histopathologic testing. So a long way to say you have risk factors, you have a culture, and you have X-ray findings. You have proven invasive aspergillosis. Probable if you have risk factors and radiologic findings backed by positive cultures from non-sterile sites or indirect testing, right? So you may not grow culture, maybe indirect. That's probable invasive aspergillosis. And then possible if you have risk factors, clinical findings, and X-rays, but not growing anything out. So you're just worried about it, but you're not growing it. It's possible you have invasive aspergillosis. So treatment for aspergillosis is going to be voriconazole, one of the azoles you have. However, there's a very high failure rate, and the next option would be an amphotericin, one of your amphotericins. So in conclusions, looking at the objectives, the epidemiology, these organisms are everywhere. They become invasive in sick patients. The risk factors, again, if you have a sick ICU patient with a lot of stuff going on, they're going to be a risk factor for invasive candidiasis or aspergillosis. The diagnosis is very difficult and very elusive, and you should have a high index of suspicion based on risk factors. And the treatment, though we do have antifungals that work for these in some cases, again, in some patients, the treatment fails often, and you may need to consider changing antibiotic or antifungals. And it really depends a lot on your antibiogram, what you grow at your institution, and how it responds to antibiotic therapy. If you have any questions, feel free to email me for any questions or clarifications. Thank you very much.
That's great, Carlos. Thank you. Our next speaker is Lynette Scherer. She's president of Surgical Affiliates. She's the trauma medical director at Mercy San Juan. She'll talk about DVT prophylaxis in the ICU and who's calling the shots. Lynette.
Good morning. Mary, Dr. Maddox, thank you very much for having me back to this conference. It's always a pleasure to be a part of this conference. I have no disclosures to make about this talk, but I think that when I saw this topic come back again, I'm certain that over the last decade, we've discussed this at least a half a dozen times at this conference. So I am certain that you all actually know the answer to this. And you come to this conference and you hear national experts in anticoagulation and trauma. We even had a trauma neurosurgeon. They give you some guidelines and you go home. And it's really hard to get your crew to get in line. Maybe not so much the trauma team, but getting your neurosurgeon colleagues or your orthopedic surgery colleagues to agree to an algorithm. So these algorithms are available at all of our websites for our national groups. And so instead of reviewing something you already know, I'm going to talk a little bit about how we can get to uniformity and consensus on these guidelines that we actually already know. So the first is what doesn't work. Telling them to do it, it just doesn't work. This is particularly true, I have an opportunity to work in a lot of different settings. This is particularly true in the community setting. Telling them to do it just leads to contention. So I know it's early for a news flash, and I hate to upset some of you, but as the trauma medical director, it's not about you. So I know it's hard. So when you sit down to have these meetings with people, you cannot lead with, I want or I need. Because that is going to lead to a discussion where you both recite what you want and need and you don't come to any agreement by the end. So remember that it's really about the patient, obviously, but helping them get there is what's important. So you have to leave your ego at the door on this one. Listen first. This may sound intuitive, but I think a lot of us go to these meetings and discussions sort of with an outline in our head, and we get up and we present the algorithm, and here it is, and here's all the data, and this is why you should do it. You haven't even heard, I mean, they stopped listening to you at the beginning because you haven't even heard what their issue is. So rather than leading with all of your fancy statistics and all of the reasons why they should do this, ask. What's your concern about this algorithm? How do you see it playing out? And listen to what they say. You'll find that sometimes it's a very simple simple issue that they just can't get past. So listen first, and that really takes you back to number one, right? It's not about you. So there's some data actually behind what makes people an effective negotiator or an effective persuader. And this is the three C's. Some of you have done your MBAs have probably heard about this. These are the three C's of effective negotiators. The first is you have to be credible. So for us, that really comes down to clinical credibility. So it helps if you bail them out of a disaster a time or two. So that serves your credibility. But you also have to be consistent. So if on Mondays you do it one way and on Tuesdays you do it another, it erodes your credibility and makes you less effective as a leader. And the last one surprised me a little bit because it turns out that the most effective negotiators have the appearance of caring. not only about the topic at hand, but about the person that they're interacting with. So people want to know you care about them. And sometimes that's hard to fake. So you have to actually engage with folks. So communication. It's so easy to write an email at 3 o'clock in the morning and send it out and expect everybody to just do it the next morning. Turns out email is great for simple, communicating simple ideas and simple tasks, but it's terrible for trying to communicate complicated algorithms and for getting people to get on board with complicated ideas. You know what happens, you open up that two-page email and you go, oh, I'll deal with that later, and later never comes. So email is not the place to launch that idea. The hallway, great, you run into people in the hallway all the time. It's not the place to launch into your 20-minute discussion of what's the best algorithm. There's actually some data around this as well. It turns out that for getting consensus on complicated ideas, an in-person discussion is 34 times more likely to end in the preferred outcome. So all of those things that happen during an in-person discussion confer success. So this one, I'm so guilty of this, which is, you go to have a discussion with somebody and all I hear is wah, 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 because I am so busy formulating what all of my arguments to them are going to be. So try and listen to people without formulating your arguments. And I included a picture of Epictetus here who reminds us that you were born with two ears and one mouth. We often forget what comes on the other side of the comma, which is so that we can listen twice as much as we speak. And I know that's hard for some of us. So this one's pretty intuitive. I think most of us know that it, you know, you do the simple things first, easy things first, and then nothing's hard. This is the yes ladder. In dealing with these complicated algorithms, seek easy wins. Do the easy parts first. Do the parts that everybody can agree to first. And you get on a sort of a roll of getting people to yes, and it can help you work through these complicated algorithms. This is a reminder for the actual, for the person who's doing the negotiating. As much as you'd like to get consensus at the first meeting, know that this is a process. Don't be discouraged when it doesn't happen the first time or the first month or in the sixth month. This is not a quick deal. Sometimes it takes multiple discussions and multiple meetings, and invariably, just when you get there, there'll be a new person in the group who says, oh, no, no, we can't do it that way. Don't give up the faith that working through this process is worthwhile. The next is reciprocation. We learn this before we go to kindergarten, right? I do something for you, you do something for me. You want my toy, I share mine, you share yours. Same thing in these negotiations. And what I like to do for folks that are particular curmudgeons is to lead with a list of non-urgent consults. So here's a list of 8 things that we don't need to call you with at 2 o'clock in the morning. We'll call you tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, whatever time you want us to call you. But in exchange, let's talk about the 3 things we need you to come for within 30 minutes. So it's hard to be too irritated with me because I just told you that here's these 8 things we're not gonna bug you about. And in exchange, you sort of feel obligated to help out. we're back to the me again. So really, we're trying to look at what's in it for the patient. But sometimes when you're negotiating with others, you do have to help them see what's in it for them. And so if you can find something in there that satisfies them in that way, it's a good time to point it out. And this is for the negotiator ourselves. We're actually pretty rigid thinkers, believe it or not. But this flexibility in thinking can be learned, and especially if you're cognizant of it. So when you go in with your algorithm discussion, don't be so married to the idea that you can't give a little on something. Find the areas where you can give. People want to feel like they've contributed to the development of the algorithm. So be flexible and be willing to accept that. Now, I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying is there's 10 things that that all sounds great, but she doesn't know the joker that I work with. And here's what I hear. I hear, oh, that's great for you, but you know, I don't believe the data. That's a favorite. My patients are so much sicker than those patients in the studies. I hear that one. And the third one is, my last patient, I tried this in my last patient and it didn't work, so I don't wanna do that anymore. So if you're faced ever with people who believe that, you can show them a very fancy theorem. Here's the mathematics behind it. This is an adaptive, play the winner, is an adaptive randomization process. It's a real thing. It has complicated math, but it's exquisitely simple in its execution. And I love it in clinical settings when you have really rigid, crusty folks who just don't want to move off of their platform. It really gives them a way to do it and save a little face, and also to expose the patients to the most desirable algorithm. So how does it work? So in Play the Winner, you have two algorithms. We happen to have at one of our programs neurosurgeons who say, absolutely, positively, without a doubt, no anticoagulation for 7 days, even if it's a Ditzel, just no anticoagulation for 7 days. It's hard to get them off of that. So in Play the Winner, what you would do is say, okay, Dr. X, we're gonna have two algorithms. We're gonna have your algorithm, and that is, they like that. And we're gonna have our algorithm, which is the 24-hour algorithm. And you start out, and the first patients get put on algorithm one, and they get no DVT prophylaxis for 7 days. I mean, they're not getting it anyway, because they're writing chart wars, and they're telling us how we're gonna kill patients. And so no DVT prophylaxis. And on the second patient, there's a PE. When there's a failure, you switch to the new algorithm. So now all the patients move down and get their DVT prophylaxis at 24 hours. And you continue playing that winner until there's a failure. Patient gets a DVT. You go back to the 7. So I put some numbers on this for you. Ooh, that doesn't project perfectly. But this is another example of things we struggle with. Surgeons who want to put drains in after straightforward lap colies. So there was a time where there were some people in the group who, no matter what, insisted on putting a drain in. And we took that surgeon specifically and said, here, let's work on this. You can put in a drain, you keep putting in drains until you have a failure. And when you have a failure, you move over to our model, which is no drain. And you'll see that in 20 patients, about half of those patients ultimately got managed with no drain. It gave them an option to see that, oh, this actually works. It didn't require them to wholesale give up their ideas, and it converted somebody who was absolutely, positively recalcitrant into ultimately somebody who could get behind the algorithm. So in conclusion, I think we all know who should call the shots. We should be focused on the patient. They present with all sorts of different constellation of illnesses that require some thought. But the goal, of course, is to standardize our practice around that. And we know the data, they know the data. The point is to get to a unified algorithm. So hopefully this will help you do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Scherer. Our next speaker is Joe DuBose. He's Colonel in the U.S. Air Force. He's Professor of Surgery at USUS, and he's Director of the Baltimore Center for Sustainability of Trauma and Readiness Skills. He'll try to tell us whether rib fixation gets patients off the ventilator sooner. Joe?
Yeah, I'd like to thank Dr. Maddox and Mary again for the wonderful opportunity. We're going to talk about rib fixation here. So I have nothing to disclose relative to this or pretty much anything. Rib fractures. It's a problem. We all encounter these, correct? I mean, 10% of all injury victims have them. It contributes to pulmonary morbidity in 33%, mortality in 12%. And up to a third of our patients with rib fractures, of the chest wall survivors, commonly require some form of prolonged rehabilitation. So how can we mitigate that potential risk? Well, first, we have to speak a common language. These are the variety of terms that have been used in the literature over time. I love stove and chest. I think it just sounds, it rolls off the tongue into my South Texas vernacular. You got a stove and chest. But steering wheel injury, flail chest, all of these are terms, this flail chest first coined by Cohen in 1955. And we've dealt with these. This has been a problem for a long time. So historically, there's some fascinating ways that they've dealt with some of these things. This is a quote from 1917 that goes counter to everything that we do presently. Upon one point, everybody agrees, right? The earliest and most perfect immobilization is necessary. They wrap the chest. This is from that diagram is from a World War II manual on how to address these, as is this diagram. So comprehensive care approaches. Some of these you can see actually nerve blocks there. You can see some pulmonary toilet. Very primitive forms of respiratory support. And a variety of non-operative techniques have been described. Adhesive tape in 1941, so duct tape actually does fix everything, right? A variety of external support devices that actually fixate on the chest to mitigate the risk of those moving flail segments. So suction cup fixation or the Cape Town limpet was described in 1963, and you'll still find thoracic surgeons who describe that. This is one of my favorites. Looks so comfortable. Looks like a spa day. In 1926, bullet forceps retraction. This poor gentleman is sitting, with his chest wall retracted against some kind of hanging IV pole. Here's another. This one made from modification of ordinary coat hangers. Who knew that in your hotel rooms tonight you have state-of-the-art technology from 1940 to deal with rib fractures? I don't think it's FDA approved though. Another bent trocar, so they moved from kind of traction to a rigid fixation on the bed to actually using external kind of traction here with bent trocars, another well-described technique. Finally, however, in the 1980s, we came to these plates, and the operative reduction of internal fixation began to evolve as we understand it today. And this has proliferated a market. You can go to meetings and see there are a myriad of companies in this battle space. And some of these things are really cool looking, right? I mean, this sternal fixation device really looks pretty slick, and it's 3D printed titanium rib cage. I mean, you can't get any more Terminator than that. But the question becomes, what are the W's here? Why, when, where, how? How do we take care of these things? And first, we have to identify who potentially benefits. These are all the potential benefits of rib chest wall stabilization. You can shorten their duration of mechanical ventilation. It's a specific question we're going to ask today. But very closely related is the incidence of pneumonia, the need for tracheostomy. We just want to get these patients through the acute phase and get them on with the rest of their lives. There have been some traditional contraindications. Obviously, hemodynamically unstable patients don't make great candidates for rib fixation. That still holds true. Unstable spine and pelvic fractures, primarily because there's some positioning elements that you have to do this right. Some of the traditional ones also included severe pulmonary contusion and severe traumatic brain injury, mainly in the acute phase, because those patients are not great candidates for more prolonged fixation, and you can let them get through that acute phase. Some of that has been debated of late. When do we do this? Well, there's been a shift in recent years to doing this earlier among those patients who are likely to benefit, ideally within 24 hours, but certainly within 72 hours based upon existing recommendations. How? Lots of techniques here. The basics here are muscle sparing. We'll talk a little bit about some of these. Some great resources in your syllabus if you really want to get into the nuts and bolts of the specifics. But there are some very defined techniques from users that have a lot of experience with this technology. The surgical exposures are somewhat familiar to most of us. They are largely muscle sparing and with just really designed to get to that rib interface and fix the problem and get the muscle out of the way. And they involve basics of any fracture, right? We have to reduce it before we can plate it. The question is, though, does it really work, right? Bread gloves sound like a great option, too, but I don't know if that's going to work out either. So does it really work? What's the actual data? There are really two sources I'm going to go through. They're in your syllabus here. I personally, when I'm trying to answer a hard question, I go to somebody. There's always a smart person who's probably collated the data for me already. And this is one example of that. The Cochrane 2015 review, they looked at the randomized control trial data, 3 studies, 123 patients, so not in the greater scope of trauma care, a huge number. And they really found no clear evidence for difference in mortality, but among patients randomized to surgical reduction, they did find a reduction in pneumonia, chest wall deformity. Obviously, you're fixing that with the rib fixation, tracheostomy. And it was challenging, however, in their assessment, because there's so many different methodologies with the fixations, the timing, and the studies to really comment definitively on whether it's shortened ventilator days. Another great resource, and this was presented in 2015, East does a very great job of gathering some of this data. So this is their practice management guideline from the Eastern Association for the Surgery of Trauma. They reviewed a lot of literature here, and it really defined what are the critical endpoints that we want to look at, and did that a priori going into the examination very well. I'll do two quick slides here, and all you really have to understand here is that everything is to the left of that line. So benefit, right, it improves mortality and length of stay, and it decreases the duration of mechanical ventilation, pneumonia, and need for tracheostomy. So it's the patients that get reviewed in the literature, it clearly appears to be beneficial. But the data is a bit of a mixed bag. And when they outline this in their limitations. The qualitative synthesis in patients with non-flail chest in particular is problematic because a lot of these studies really focus on flail, and non-flail segments, no matter how many rib fractures you have, are challenging to examine. But they did examine some PICO questions. They specifically two major ones looking at the critical outcomes that they thought would be important. PICO question one was involved with non-flail segments. And essentially, based on the data that was available, the East group said that for non-flail rib fractures, they asked, should this be performed, right? And their conclusion, based on the data, is that in non-flail rib fractures, they cannot offer recommendation. There's just too much diversity in the studies out there to really say anything conclusive that's on solid statistical ground. What about flail chest, their second question? Well, here, what they identified was that there's substantial enough data that they could conditionally recommend open reduction internal fixation, as it the majority of the studies do demonstrate that it decreases mortality, shortens the mechanical duration of ventilation, ICU and hospital length of stay, decreases pneumonia and the need for tracheostomy. Another great resource here that you have to filter appropriately is the consensus statement that I'll show you and is in your syllabus that was related. These are experts. These are people who do a lot of rib fixation, right? So you have to filter your expectations through that. But they are very upfront about their background and their experience with this. But if you're going to figure out how to incorporate something into your practice, you want to talk to people who've done a lot of it. So they also, through their own filter as experts and clearly proponents of rib fixation, outlined the literature and looked at this using grade methodology, which is a very nice methodology that incorporates expert opinion into the recommendations that are developed. They looked at, I don't have time to go through all of them. There's 16 categories, multiple subcategories. They clearly understand all the questions and the minutia of those within the context of rib fixation and set out to address those. But let's talk about some of them. They do fall into general categories: patient selection, timing, the intervention technique, management, and follow-up. So these are the recommendations that these experts, people who do a lot of these procedures, came up with. So they recommended that rib fixation should be considered for all patients with flail chest. That makes sense. It should be considered in patients with multiple severe bicortical displaced rib fractures. It should be considered in patients who fail early, optimal, non-operative management, regardless of the radiographic fracture pattern. And that you really shouldn't, in present in their practice, in their experience, that pulmonary contusion or TBI should not be considered absolute contraindications. What about timing of surgery? They come out and they essentially state, based on the available literature and their own practice patterns with a lot of experience, that you should do this within 72 hours of injury. So that's a very early intercept point if you're going to affect those downstream outcomes. There's some discussion about should we regionalize this practice. We've had clear success with a lot of interventions that we use in critical care patients with regionalization. They didn't find anything there that was sufficient based on data and expert opinion to support that, however. But they do mention, and I think this is sound advice, developing a standardized rib fracture protocol. If you're going to incorporate this technology into your practices, then you should utilize that very effectively and get consensus. Preoperative imaging, CT of the chest, they did recommend these fancy 3D reconstructions. The people who do a lot of rib plating, these authors of this paper, basically said that they don't recommend doing it routinely. It does provide some very sexy pictures and helps convey the magnitude of the problem, however. What about selection for repair? So what they stated is that in general, repair of ribs 1, 2, and 11, and 12 does not really confer any additional benefit in terms of either chest wall stability or pain control. And if you have fractures within 2.5 centimeters of the transverse processes, that's a tough place to get to. Probably not worth the runs. The slide is not worth the run. And so those should not be repaired. Similar for kind of guidance for the costal margin. If you're going to address those, you need to have a plan for fixation up to the cartilage or the sternum. And rib fractures should be repaired sequentially and not in every other type of pattern. If you're going to go in and do it. The techniques, the incision should be based upon fracture pattern. That makes sense. Muscle sparing techniques should be utilized. That also seems to make sense. There are technologies in individuals who've described percutaneous or even thoracoscopic approaches. At present, that's not where the standard of care for this technique lies. With regards to fixation techniques, plates or intramedullary struts can both be utilized. Permanent plates do appear to offer superior strength and reliability compared to absorbable plates, which are also out there on the market. The bottom line for flail chest fixation is that surgical stabilization of flail chest does appear to confer benefit in terms of both vent weaning, length of stay, and complications. And if you're going to do it early, intervention at less than 72 hours appears ideal. And we need additional data, particularly in the non-flail rib fractures. But stabilization may be useful in specific patients. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Joe. Our next speaker is J. Johannigman. He's professor of surgery. He's a career military officer. He's an expert in ventilation on the ground and in the air. He'll tell us whether there's anything new in mechanical ventilation. Dr. Johannigman.
Thanks, Dr. Bernard. Good morning, y'all. It's great to be back here, and as with all the other faculty too, Mary and Dr. Maddox, it's great to be here, but Dr. Maddox, I also tell you that for those of you who are here the first time, it's humbling to watch this younger faculty as they come along. Their horse is running awful hard and presenting lectures like Joe and others just did, so we'll try to struggle and stay up. And Dr. Scherer, you're the fox in sheep's clothing, man. And I don't be careful if I came up to me, you came up to me in the middle of a hallway with that smile. Something's going to happen to me. Anyway, what's new in ventilation? We'll try to walk through these sequential algorithms that have been written about. And as I prepared for the lecture, it occurred to me that we really haven't made a great deal of advancements as far as the mechanics advancing in generations of ventilators as much as we were a decade or so ago. And I'm really interested in the panel discussion, and you had a great lecture about ECMO, because I will touch briefly on that as well. So these are the topics. I'll try to leave each of these segmental algorithms or alternatives. I'll try to give you a distinct yes or no, they do work, and what the data. I'll try to give you some data, and your data is provided in the syllabus as well. Before we get anywhere, the best way to avoid the complications of mechanical ventilation is just don't do it. This is one of my favorite quotes. Mechanical ventilation is a crude and ugly mechanical torture. If you think about it, as human beings, over 3 million years of evolution, we have developed a system of breathing based exclusively on the generation of negative intrathoracic pressure to draw air into our lungs. And yet, when somebody has respiratory failure, we turn that whole mechanical, physiologic, pneumatic system on its head by, instead of creating negative intrathoracic pressure, we start piling and hammering positive pneumatic pressure into the lungs. And I think that's why we still struggle with all the ventilator-associated lung complications as we do today. Well, what are some strategies to avoid mechanical ventilation and intubation? This is one that I honestly have to tell you, for about the first 3 or 4 years, I just disregarded and didn't even pay attention. Oh, it's just a funny-looking nasal cannula. Well, it's more than just a funny-looking nasal cannula. It's an effective and therapeutic tool. Why is that? Well, a couple of things make this different than just a nasal cannula. Number one, the nasal prongs are actually much larger than a standard nasal cannula. So they're meant to provide an occlusive fit inside the nares. And the second thing is the amount of flow going through this nasal cannula, instead of 4, 6, 7, 8 liters per minute, is actually 60 liters per minute. So that those two design configurations actually allow this cannula to work efficiently to both improve oxygenation and eliminate carbon dioxide, decrease dead space. The cartoon you see here kind of tries to explain this. This is actually from a respiratory therapy site, and it really does a nice job. Up on top, you see the traditional nasal cannula, 6 liters per minute. When a patient inspires, they're going to be asking anywhere from 40 to 60 and sometimes as much as 80 liters per minute. So if your nasal cannula is giving 6 and the patient's drawing in 60, you can do the math of that dilution, and that's why nasal cannulas generally do not inspire or do not enrich the inspired oxygen concentration as much as we would think. You put them on high flow, essentially you're trading what used to be the external reservoir bag on a traditional non-rebreathing mask, and you're moving that reservoir into the nasopharynx in the upper airway. So now when that patient inspires, two things happen. They already have a reservoir of enriched oxygen in the back of their throat,
and 60 liters per minute can meet their oxygenation and their flow demands. In addition, that 60 liters of oxygen in between inspiratory efforts is washing out CO2, so it decreases dead space, so you have the benefits of both oxygenation and ventilation. There are actually studies now, mostly from the Japanese literature, that actually shows that use of high-flow nasal cannula reduces the need for intubation. And there you can see the actual studies with significant differences in the rate of intubation for patients treated with high-flow nasal cannulas versus traditional oxygen therapy. So step number one is use high-flow nasal cannulas. They work primarily for patients who have a deficit of oxygenation. Excuse me. So the second type of non-invasive ventilatory strategy should actually be called, and I apologize, this should actually be non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. Again, emphasizing the ability to pressurize the upper airway above the glottis, and you see the various techniques that can be utilized. I actually have no familiarity with that space helmet there. I thought it looked kind of cool, but I can't imagine my vet patients tolerating that very well. I can see that that would be kind of a hazard. But generally speaking, the nasal tight-fitting nasal CPAP and or the tight-fitting nasal full face mask are generally tolerated pretty well. So what you have is the two primary modalities is high-flow nasal cannula versus non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. The left side of the panel, high-flow nasal cannula, works well for oxygenation. The non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, which most of us think of as BiPAP and is BiPAP, that works better for the patient who has a ventilatory or CO2 elimination deficit, and the literature supports those strategies with data studies that suggest that these are both modalities to statistically significantly decrease the need or the incidence for mechanical ventilation. So let's go on and move to the patient now. We've had to go ahead and intubate them. What about the use of neuromuscular blockades? Unequivocally, one of the strategies that I would leave you with is neuromuscular blockade has now been shown to be statistically associated with a decrease in mortality with two key caveats. Use it early, and you only need to use it for 48 hours, okay? This is the trial published in the New England Journal where they use cisatricurium. So why does neuromuscular blockade work? It works if you use it early, and I use it to eliminate all the other variables of the patient who's descending into respiratory distress. If they're tachypneic, if they're fighting you during the ventilator, by taking that out of the equation, you have the ability in the first 24 to 48 hours to titrate the patient on all these other modalities, such as PEEP and tidal volume, so that you get that patient in the sweet spot where Dr. Zonies and I both agree that if you're going to get anywhere with a patient in respiratory distress, you must work early. You got 48 hours to optimize them. And MBA allows you to optimize, and this study showed this benefit, this mortality benefit, with less than 48 hours. The trial was only 48 hours, and then the patients were allowed to begin resuming spontaneous ventilation. So we've added that into our algorithm. Real quickly, high-frequency oscillation, I was exposed to it in the military along with the VDR ventilator. There are now two trials that pretty much equivocally say that there really is no advantage for high-frequency oscillation. I would suspect that the number of hands in this room who have centers that still do HFO is now probably down to less than a dozen. The reason being is that both these two studies have shown that there really was no demonstrable improvement for high-frequency oscillation. It requires a lot of technical expertise. It requires a lot of sedation. It requires a lot of volume loading without a apparent benefit, and in fact, that first study I showed you actually was stopped because it showed increased mortality in the high-frequency oscillation group, so I think we can put this to rest. It was a great modality, helped us learn about the way the lung could work or the alternative ways versus mass movement of air, but it's no longer, in my consideration, a part of the algorithm that we should be using. What about APRV? You go certain geographical areas of the United States, and APRV is now seen as the third coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm old enough that I've seen it come and go now three times. It works, but it'll be interesting. Over the last 25 years, it was actually introduced in the 80s, and since the 80s, there's only one paper that even attempted to show that there's a benefit, and that came out with the null hypothesis. So this is like, you know, are you a Yankees or a Mets, are Yankees or a Red Sox fan? It's passion, but there's very little science to say that APRV has any distinct advantages. My good friend Rich Branson, who taught me everything I know about respiratory therapy, as you know, APRV is essentially very severe inverse, or as Rich says, perverse ratio ventilation, okay? It works, but it works because it elevates the mean airway pressure. That's why it works. And essentially, it's doing what we said earlier. It recruits. Those patients who have ARDS, you put them on APRV early, you're recruiting them early, and that's why PEEP works, that's why neuromuscular blockade works, that's why APRV works. But why? And I will tell you, I have a distinct prejudice and a bias as a trauma and acute care surgeon. APRV is very, very dangerous early on in the patient who is under-resuscitated, because you're elevating that airway pressure, you're decreasing venous return, and you watch that patient go on APRV, and the next thing you're reaching for is volume loading. Okay, so if it doesn't offer a distinct advantage, elevate PEEP, elevate your mean airway from coming from below rather than going up top and high. There's the randomized prospective trial of airway pressure release ventilation. It was a null hypothesis. There's no distinct advantage to APRV in the literature that I've been able to read. Low versus high PEEP. I'm going to come to the bottom line up front. There's no difference, but the point of the matter is you should pick either a low or a high PEEP table and stick to it. If you walk through my ICU today, you're going to find every possible combination of PEEP and FiO2. That is silly. There are standards, and either the low table or the high table has been shown to benefit and improve oxygenation. We should not be randomizing patients based upon the house officer or the respiratory therapist prejudice at the bedside. These two studies showed they were stopped for futility. There was no difference between either the high or the low PEEP, but there are definitely tables to help guide you so that you know you've gone up your algorithm appropriately, and if that patient really is on a high level of inspired oxygen, there's a reason and you've already tried to PEEP. This also brings to mind something called recruitment maneuvers. They are still of value. We use recruitment maneuvers early because if somebody's FI or PaO2 goes up with a recruitment maneuver, that tells me they have recruitable lung and I need to use more PEEP, and so I look at my PEEP table and where I am. Now, here's the one takeaway, and this is where I'm looking forward to the panel, because prone positioning, as David correctly pointed out in his lecture, we've looked at prone positioning many, many times over the years, and there's always been an improvement in oxygenation, but there never was an improvement in mortality until this paper. And now there is the demonstrated improvement in mortality. Why did they get it in this study? Well, first of all, because they were really selective. They looked at severe ARDS, a P to F ratio not less than 200, but a P to F ratio of less than 150. Let's go over why proning works. The physiology of this just makes sense. When you have that patient with ARDS in the prone position, that wet, heavy lung is pushing and compressing the remaining lung, as you can see so readily in this picture, in addition to the heart. When you flip somebody upside down, that wet, heavy lung is going to try to fall away from the pleural space. It can't do that because of surface tension. Therefore, the pleural space is going to have to pull back with a huge negative pressure. Okay? So the lung wants to fall down, the pleural pressure, the capillary interface has to, or the surface tension interface has to pull back, and as a result, that lung sitting there upside down has a huge negative pressure gradient, so that when you ventilate with positive pressure is going to go to the biggest negative pressure source, which is right in that lung you want to recruit. That's why prone makes so much sense in a lung with early ARDS. And here is the data now in the New England Journal that shows a statistically significant difference in proning. Again, when do you prone? You have to prone them early. And in our unit, do we buy a rotoprone bed at 12 hours? No, we don't. I would suggest to you, if you want to know if proning works, and proning works somewhere between 70 to 85% of all patients in early ARDS are going to show a 20% improvement, do it early, flip them in your unit with pillows, give them 4 hours, and if you see a P to F ratio improve, then go invest in your rotoprone bed, then go put them down. Oh, by the way, this trial was 16 continuous hours each day. So it's prolonged proning, and they showed the mortality benefit. So it's not just a little bit of proning, it's a lot of proning. The last of the strategies is a very simple one. I honestly had to read this paper 3 or 4 times. It's a little hard to understand, but the bottom line is, at the bedside now, this new algorithm called driving pressure. Driving pressure is nothing more than looking at your plateau pressure minus your PEEP. The bigger or the higher or the greater the driving pressure you're using on that patient at the bedside with ARDS, the more worry and concern you have. Amato, when Amato speaks about ARDS, I listen. This is his paper, and essentially what he's telling us is that based upon this driving pressure, using low tidal volumes and using a relatively consistent tidal volume between 4 to 6 to 8 kilos or cc's per kilo, we're going to be able to look at changes in compliance over the course of the patient's disease, and the higher the driving pressure, the more you worry about that patient, and I'd be more ready to move to ECMO if the driving pressure using limited tidal volumes are beginning to escape my ability and they're beginning to rise above 15 to 17. Now that's going to engage me in that conversation with Dr. Zonies about now it's time because I've worked through my algorithm. So I didn't have enough time, and gratefully, you know, that's why we're here together with Dr. Zonies. I'm looking forward to having this discussion, but I would portend that if you look, our unit has an algorithm. This is our ARDS algorithm that we stepped through it sequentially. We did a performance improvement initiative and looked how many times did we follow this algorithm before we were requesting ECMO. And disappointingly, we followed this algorithm 15% of the time before we were calling for ECMO. A national study recently looked at the number of patients being put on ECMO across the United States and found out that only 60% of patients going on ECMO had even had a single trial of proning. So I think we might be perhaps rushing the gun, and I would look forward to talking to the rest of the panelists about this in the subsequent discussions. So thank you very much, Dr. Bernard, my good friend. Thank you very much, Dr. Maddox. It's always a pleasure.
Okay, our last presenter in this terrific session is Dr. Matthew Wall. He's professor at the Baylor College of Medicine. He's an icon in our world. I think of him as a surgeon's surgeon. He'll talk to us this morning about the non-evacuated clotted hemothorax and fibrothorax, best approach. Dr. Wall.
Thank you for your kind introduction. I'd like to thank the program committee for the ability to spend a little time with you today. So let's talk about intrapleural fluid collections and maybe take this a little bit beyond hemothorax for just a minute or so. There's a spectrum, post-traumatic, post-infectious, and transudative, and start look at some of the principles. Empyemas can be categorized as serous, purulent, fibrin purulent slash chronic. And these have implications for therapy. For example, you have a serous empyema. If you do a complete thoracentesis, get them on the right treatment, that's usually all you need. If you have a purulent one, they're a little thicker, you need a chest tube or a pigtail. But the key is to get complete drainage. And you know, at least at our hospital, we have a real problem with some of the serous empyemas because they might have a diagnostic tap and then everybody waits to get the results of that. And by then it's progressed on to become a purulent one. Now you're putting in chest tubes, maybe operating on them. So, you know, one of the takeaway points for serous empyemas is drain them early with a complete thoracentesis. The fibrin purulent ones are the ones that everybody's familiar with. They're incompletely drained. They're often later, excuse me, in the time course. And there's varying degree of fibrous rind, excuse me. Sorry about that. And they also have a real issue with sepsis, because if you don't get them drained, you know, we've seen some of these people where, you know, early in my training, we're going to put a chest tube with somebody in the MICU, and we got busy, and we went to do it the next day, went by, and they died of sepsis. So, you know, this is pus under pressure. You got to at least get them drained. So the goals. First, get them drained to prevent bacteremia. You may end up with a trapped lung. Then second is expand the lung. Around the turn of the century, the Empyema Committee commissioned after the flu epidemics in the early 1900s, you know, talked about, you know, getting these things drained. They didn't have positive pressure ventilation, so they'd pack the wound, try to get it to stick so they could open and get the pus out. But then if you can, you know, most of us go on and try to re-expand the lung, address the space problem. That usually requires a procedure. Whether you do it VATS or open to decortication depends on the skill of the operator, depends on the stage. Often these are further along than you think. You know, we're all surgeons are inherently optimists. They think it won't be too bad, but it's always worse than you expect, you know. So just have that mindset that it's going to be a bigger case than you think. You know, the bowel obstruction, you know, it's nice that it's one adhesion, but it's often you're going to be whacking away for a while. You have these chronic hard fibrous rinds. They're difficult to remove without damaging the lungs. At least in my hands, that's harder to do with a VATS. It's hard to find a good plane. So operative management, the problem is you end up with these raw surfaces and these air leaks, and it's the, you know, equivalent thing to the enterotomies and small bowel obstructions. So at the earlier stage where you can see a plane, you can get the rind off, and you're comfortable with it, you could do a VATS. But if they're further along in the thing, think you're going to be an open decortication. But you got to be able to accomplish the principles of getting good drainage and achieve lung expansion. Now, if you are going to do VATS, you know, good judgment comes from experience, and experience comes from bad judgment. I like to talk about all the ways I've gotten trouble in my life, but that way you don't have to experience it too. Look at the imaging very carefully and enter with your ports in an area where there's a space to avoid lung injury. Because, you know, we're pretty determined to get in the chest sometimes, and you work, and you finally get in, and it gets really easy. And all of a sudden, you realize the path of least resistance is actually through the middle of the lung. You've created this tremendous lung injury and air leak and all that kind of stuff. But if you get the ports in, look at the nature of the rind. If it's early and relatively limited, you can keep on with the VATS. Otherwise, convert to open. So again, the nature of the rind, the anatomy, and the experience. For the open approach, again, you could start with a small incision, but you often need a generous thoracotomy. Spare the muscles, particularly the lat, if you can, because this will allow you to have a future muscle flap for a space issue. Take a rib going in. It gives you a bigger intercostal space to get in, a little more room to work around, try to find the right plane. It's also kind of a tailoring thoracoplasty. Now, nobody does thoracoplasties anymore, but this makes the pleural space smaller, so you have to expand the lung a little bit less. Another little trick. Now, this is a drawing from an old thoracic surgery textbook where these things were done much more common. It's usually a subpleural dissection. Again, like small bowel obstructions, work from easy to difficult. Know the anatomy. The apex and the sulcus can be difficult. Be very careful with the diaphragm because, again, you can go blasting right through it, and it's like, wow, why am I feeling the spleen? That's kind of a disconcerting activity. Now you're reattaching the diaphragm with all kinds of crazy devices. And so just be a little careful there. And, you know, the Pacinian corpuscles will allow you to find the plane and peel it off the diaphragm, because unfortunately it's often have to be done somewhat tactile as opposed to visual. So the next part of the conduct of the operation is once you've got so get the purulent stuff drained, mobilize the lung. Now you have this globular looking lung. Start looking for a plane. Again, like a bowel obstruction, start on the easy parts. Often needs sharp dissection. Start with a knife. Try to find an appropriate layer. Again, if it's really easy, it might be because you're in the wrong plane. If you see this sort of strawberry thing that's bleeding, you're probably subpleural. When you inflate the lung, you get a bunch of air leaks. But once you get that plane, be very jealous of it and keep it as long as you can. Keep working it as far as you can, combination of blunt and sharp dissection. So this is not an uncommon kind of picture that you'll see. Get as much rind as possible from the visceral surface. And another one of the keys is that Laplace's law says, you know, the object of least tension is sort of a globe, right? So if you really get the rind, the lung will become like a globe. It'll become the angles, and you'll start seeing the angles again. That way you know you're making some progress. Work until you can get the lung to expand to fill the space. If you can't get off a hard, white, fibrous peel, at least drain the pus. Sometimes you do this tortoise shell thing. It's pretty unsatisfying, but can sometimes allow some expansion. Get hemostasis. These are bloody operations. Look at the chest wall. It's hard to look at. Look at all the places you struggle. Put warm packs. Get stuff to clot. Where you get in trouble is the ends of the incision near the spine, the segmental vessels. You've often dinged them. But with the retractor in place, they're stretched out. And then you close the chest. In the ICU, they're dumping blood. And that's just kind of an aggravating activity. Inflate the lung. Overso air leaks. The more air leaks you can deal with, the less issues you're going to have. There are some adhesives you can use, but try to control the raw surface. One of the most important technical aspects in thoracotomies is proper chest tube placement. Solves many issues. It's completely underappreciated. We make errors because we sometimes get the decortication done. We leave the most junior person to do this part. But get a good anterior tube to the apex. The lung is going to collapse to wherever the tip of your anterior tube is. So Arthur Bell, one of our mentors, used to put his thumb on the apex of the chest x-ray, and if the tube wasn't underneath the thumb, he said we were fired. But you know, if you look at it, the lung seals around the tube. Now the part above it isn't draining air, so the lung collapses to that level. Put a posterior tube in for drainage. Another trick is if, say you have a mid part of the lung, you're really having trouble getting the rind off, put a tube in that area, because that's an area that may not fully expand. You may get some fluid, but if you leave a tube there, you've drained the pus. It's an empyema tube, and you can back it out over time. It'll save you from having to do some post-op stuff. And then have patient, i.e. the provider being patient, chest tube management. Don't be shucking tubes out too fast. Fibrinolytics are good for early fibrinopurulent empyemas, done mostly on medical patients. It's multiple installations of TPA and deoxyribonuclease. The deoxyribonuclease dissolves DNA, can liquefy fluid, some early septations. One of the things to recognize is that TPA is a lot like warfarin. It has different bioavailability depending upon which configuration, which hospital you have. So where I learned about it is from vascular, from lysing clots and stuff like that. Our vascular surgeon told me our TPA has twice the activity than the ones that he had at the Cleveland Clinic. So keep an eye on fibrinogen. We've had some people bleed, so we'll actually check fibrinogen after the second run of TPA. And it's been interesting because some gets very low. All right, the topic at hand, the retained clot hemothorax management principles: prevent with an appropriate chest tube. Again, chest tubes are probably the most underappreciated procedures we do. Evaluate the chest x-ray for drainage. So if you put in a chest tube, you're duty bound to look at it and say to yourself, did the lung expand? Did I drain the chest? And obviously do this in a timely manner. Now, I have to admit, I didn't always believe this, but I learned from one of my mentors, Dr. Demetriotis, that the chest x-ray is not always reliable to discern clot from contusion. In fact, 50% of the time, it's not reliable. So get early cross-sectional imaging on anybody who you have any concern, because that allows you to have early decision-making. Remember, hope is not a strategy. I hope it'll be okay. It'll be fine, you know. We used to have a colleague we called the minimizer. If he didn't understand something, he said, oh, it'll be okay. Don't worry. That usually doesn't go well. Avoid a second chest tube. If you're putting in a second chest tube, it's probably not going to work. And the problem is it delays you a couple days. So have a clinical pathway. And what a lot of folks have done, we've done, is we get a CT on day two if there's any concern. That way we make a decision for VATS. If you can do a VATS within 3 to 4 days, it's an easy evacuation. It's essentially video-directed suction. You know, before the days of VATS, we used to make these little bitty thoracotomies, just reaching with our fingers and scoop out the clots, and now we can do it with a VATS, and it's simple. But you have to do it before the clot organizes. So do the VATS before the blood becomes organized. So you got to look at the imaging, you got to get the cross-sectional imaging, you got to make the decision, and then get them to the operating room. So there's some logistical stuff that you got to sort of hardwire. Now, I know this doesn't happen in anybody else's hospital, but unfortunately, many are not addressed until day 7-8, right? I mean, there's pragmatic aspects of this. You know, there's issues with the patient, it gets away from you. And they get to that point, the clot is starting to organize. So now it's starting to get sticky, it's starting to get fibrotic. If you're a highly skilled operator, again, like the regular empyemas, you can consider a VATS decortication. But again, you got to satisfy the principles of getting the clot out and dealing with the rind. And it's not uncommon that people will try a VATS. They'll say, oh, you know, I'll just put in a couple ports. You try a VATS. You don't really get the rind off. And now you're doing a decortication a week later. So if you have to, you know, be honest with yourself. Say, I didn't, you know, didn't get there. I need to open. In my mind, if it's after 7 to 10 days, I'm thinking open decortication is needed. Fibrinolytics for trauma, there's reports by some that it's safe and effective. It's not universally accepted. This is one of these things that's like, stay tuned. The other thing that's driven this is if you read the papers, the conclusions of most of them is that VATS is really effective if done early. It's considered, there's a couple studies where it's considered in some patients that don't have an arterial injury, don't have an intercostal injury, don't have significant lung injury. And, you know, how do you pick those, I guess, is some of the concern. Or those that have comorbidities that make the VATS risky. I know I had a coronary that, you know, the left chest had a hemothorax after the mammary takedown, and we gave some of the TPA, and after the second dose, the guy bled 3 liters of blood, and I had to take him back. And, you know, cardiac surgeons are the most superstitious people. You do something once, you'll never do it again. So kind of waiting to see what the data is going to be on this. It's suggested that if you're going to do that for trauma, use TPA alone. So watch this, it's evolving. The East suggestion is intrapleural thrombolytics can be used to improve drainage of subacute, loculator, exudative collections, particularly in patients where risks of thoracotomy are significant. It's considered a second-line agent behind surgical intervention when the risk of surgery is significant. So in summary, prevent a clotted hemothorax with a timely, well-placed chest tube, assure full drainage, otherwise get an early CT scan to differentiate hemothorax from contusion or collapse, evacuated clotted hemothorax with VATS early. Use of fibrolytics is evolving and still being investigated, so stay tuned. Empyemas are classified as serous, purulent, and fibrin purulent. Serous empyemas are managed with a complete thoracentesis, purulent empyemas with tube thoracostomy. Fibrin purulent are usually treated with operative drainage and possible decortication. And purulent empyemas are early. Fibrin purulent maybe respond to fibrolytic therapy. Thank you.
That was a fantastic session. I want to thank all of our great presenters, and thank you all for your questions. The panelists certainly generated some great discussion here. Alison, I'll start with you, if I may. Tell us who is on your rapid response team, and does anybody get notified of a rapid response activation other than the team, the rapid response team? How does your team get notified that an RRT has been called?
Yep, so our rapid response team is, we've done a mix of everything just because of the data. So if the nurse picks up the phone and knows that he or she needs help, then that's a full rapid response, and that's one of our stat nurses, respiratory therapist, and one of our ICU APPs that's specially trained to go do the rapid response. If it's auto-triggered based off of the chart, the first thing that happens when that score hits like a five, then that page is auto-paged to the charge nurse on that floor. So Epic can do all this behind the scenes. So that particular floor's charge nurse gets a page, so-and-so in this room, you score is five. So he or she can go and look at it. We think that that's also caused some good interventions and heightened phone calls to the primary services that perhaps didn't happen in the past. Then if they hit a score of a seven, or if the patient's muse, since the last time it was calculated, has changed by four, that will activate a limited rapid response, which is just the nurse and the RT. So we have it done a couple of ways. So the ability for the bedside nurse to call for help, as well as sort of this auto trigger because there's been a change, allows us to effectively deploy things. And what we found is that in the ones where the nurses call, 70% of the time, something's going on that needs an intervention. So that's an important one. But just auto-activation by the Muse score has been very helpful as well.
Can I see a show of hands among the panelists? Who has a rapid response team at their hospital? So the vast majority. Okay. Should there be different activation criteria or different teams for surgical versus medical patients, or should the institution have one standard and deploy that all the time? Allison?
So we find it to be easiest and least confusing. So we have our rapid response team, and then there's still the code team. And you know, the code team comes for full arrest or if we need to do an intubation on the floor. We do not, and we have noticed that the physiologic derangements, whether it's surgical or whether it's medical or neuro or anything, are really the same. So we just have the one team. Now, the other thing that I failed to bring up is that in looking at a cost analysis, because originally we had used our code team to go to any problem where they were called, and so sometimes that would be the little old lady who fell down in the lobby and somebody, the concierge person needed some help. So now the RRT will go to that, the limited one. But we have found a savings of between $20,000 to $28,000 per month just on our cost savings of not utilizing the code team, and that even takes into account employing the new nurses. So we found it to be very cost-effective.
Big financial benefit in addition to clinical.
Yep.
Dr. Zonies, lots of questions about ECMO and your talk. Can you start, please, by defining ECPR for us?
Sure. I'm sorry. ECPR is ECMO-supported CPR. So it's an evolving area for ECMO support. So if you again look at the 2015 American Heart Association guidelines for advanced cardiac life support, ECMO is now listed. The real question is at what point is it appropriate to put a patient on support? So if you've got refractory ventricular tachycardia or ventricular fibrillation that you can't break them of it, or they're in like a VT storm, you can put a patient on ECMO support. And there are some centers that put them on very quickly. The question is, how long can you possibly wait? And so we really don't have the exact answer yet, but it's probably somewhere between 30 and 60 minutes. So if you're still coding someone for 40 minutes, you should consider ECMO. And in some centers, they'll just call the team immediately down to the emergency department. Once you get them on support, you can then take them to do a percutaneous intervention, or you just wait for them to recover. And so this is an area that it's a hybrid between surgeons and emergency medicine and a close relationship with the cath lab. But you're probably going to see more and more patients being put on ECPR support.
Do you have a maximum runtime that's hard and fast, or is it like any other end-of-life care, requires communication and consideration of many variables?
Great question. So the longest run has been reported is like 650 days. Now, that's an extreme. The average, if you look at all the data, the average runtime for VV support, so for respiratory failure, is about 14 days, and for cardiac support, it's about 7 to 10 days. Our protocol, and only because I have an interest in palliative care and I'm boarded in palliative care, is when we created our team, we had an auto consultation to the palliative care service. And so because it's a high-risk, life-threatening problem, we bring them in immediately and start that conversation. And just like any therapy, once they're on support, at any given time, if it's not consistent with the surrogate or the family decision, or it looks like it's going in the wrong direction, we do withdraw life-sustaining therapy, including just turning off the ECMO support. So it's still on an individualized basis, but we do certainly have the buy-in early, realizing, and we do tell patients and families that we don't really have a known endpoint, but we can give them some rough estimates about what we think it's going to look like.
Who are the primary ECMO program directors? Are they cardiovascular surgeons, anesthetists, surgeons, emergency medicine physicians, and is that distribution changing?
So the ECMO came out of the cardiac surgery world. So in many programs, it's still cardiovascular medicine, cardiac surgery. CT surgeons tend to be running these programs. It is absolutely changing. ECMO is now an ICU mission, and you're finding more and more general surgeons, trauma, acute care surgeons taking on that role. You're finding anesthesiologists taking on that role and integrating emergency medicine. This is a multidisciplinary team sport, and it is really no longer in the domain of CT surgery.
Anybody else on the panel run a program, or does your section run an ECMO program? Any other panelists? Jay, you guys run it.
Actually, just the opposite. I don't. But to the audience, I just want you to listen to that previous response by Dr. Zonies. And if you're in an institution trying to figure out whether you have a valid and critical ECMO service, you look for somebody who does it like this. I've had the good fortune. I've worked with Dave. We first met when we were in theater almost 10 years ago. But what you want to hear from your ECMO team, the first question I ask an ECMO team is, what percentage of the patients you evaluate do you actually turn down? And David and Jeremy Cannon, who are two young previous Air Force surgeons, tell me by experience about 50% of the patients we just turned down because they're not appropriate candidates. This isn't a hammer looking for a nail. It is, you need to find somebody who has that full scope and breadth of both surgical experience to put these cannulas in, but also that's brilliant to have palliative care involved, because patients do end up getting stuck on ECMO forever. So if you want to know whether you have a valid ECMO team, ask them how many patients they actually turned down.
Other panelists running ECMO programs?
So we have an ECMO program that started about 2 years ago, I guess, and it primarily is a base, because most of the patients still coming out tend to be cardiac. But most of the VV patients tend to be pulmonary. So we'll take them down to the CVICU primarily because that's where a lot of the nursing expertise is, and then a lot of the additional equipment. And it's really run by the intensivist, which is a blend of medicine, pulmonary critical care, and then I have one of my brilliant young faculty who's a trauma back person who also participates in that group.
Joe?
Yeah, at Shock Trauma, we do have a dedicated service. We actually have a lung resuscitation unit that all these patients go to, and a critical care receiving unit that really represents the regionalization of these kind of bad pulmonary issues and taking care of them. And about 50% of the patients that come over that the outside hospital says this patient needs ECMO don't need ECMO. They just really need somebody with some smart ventilation strategies and the support mechanism that builds around that. But that regionalization concept has really been, I think ECMO has been kind of a standard for perfecting how that regionalization concept in an area can be performed very well.
At my own personal place, it's a very solid community program, and as Dave said, really is supported by the cardiac surgeons. The patients kept in the trauma ICU, the cardiac surgeons come down and help manage the patients in our ICU.
Dr. Zonies, two-part question here. I had a number of questions from the audience about saying we're not going to develop an ECMO program. You've raised our awareness of the role for this tool. How do I develop a relationship with my nearest ECMO center? How do I get over those cases where I call them and they say that's not indicated, and we feel like we have a patient we could salvage here? Can you describe how you develop that relationship and the few key bullet things you should do before you go to ECMO? Ventilation strategy, pulmonary vasodilators, proning, what should be that sequence?
Yeah, so you know, we have one of just two ECMO centers in our entire state, and so we have formed these relationships with lots of hospitals that want to don't want to start their program or don't have the resources but want to be able to send to us. And so I'd say number one is that anyone can go to the ELSO website. It's elso.org, and you can see there's a Google map that shows you where every center is in the United States and worldwide. Just call the center. They actually list the phone numbers of all the ECMO coordinators and just start the conversation. On our side, we went out and we just and became a resource, an educational resource, to explain what the indications were. We sent out information. It's all on our website, and you can just, most centers will have something like that. The biggest ask that we have is to call early. What we often find is that we get the phone call after they've been doing all the right things, and it's now 10, 14 days later, and they've run out of options, and they give us a call. And unfortunately, in most of those cases, there's really not much that we can offer because they've been doing all the right things. It's just they're in a bad situation. If we can get the patients over early, consult early, and then make a decision, if they're going to go on support, we'd like to get them there in the first 3 or 4 or 5 days. Beyond that, there's not much else we can do.
Prone before ECMO?
Yes.
Pulmonary vasodilators?
You know, if you're thinking about pulmonary vasodilators, I think you need to be sending the patient. And in some cases, you bring them to us, and we still don't put them on support. And, you know, the first few times, people were like, I called you because I wanted you to go on it. I thought you were going to put them on ECMO. I'm like, well, you know, things change. The patient was getting better. Or there was something else that we uncovered that we realized that they were just not going to be a good candidate. But I think it's just that early phone call.
Dr. Kaplan, is percutaneous drainage considered source control?
Yeah, in many cases it is.
Yeah. How much antimicrobial after percutaneous drainage?
No more than 48 hours, unless, you know, they show systemic signs. Again, the antibiotics for percutaneous drainage is because you may get some spillage of bacteria systemically to kind of, abate that, but no more than 24 hours, 48 hours in our place.
What's your workhorse antimicrobial for secondary peritonitis, diverticulitis, appendicitis, and how long do you continue therapy?
It used to be ciproflagyl. We've gone over cefin now to stay away from cipro. And generally, when they're in a hospital, it's maybe 3 to 4 days, and at max, we'll send them out with a week's worth of therapy and convert them to oral. But we stayed away from cipro because of its high incidence of C. diff now.
So a lot of questions about biofilms and whether you have a routine or algorithm at your institution for managing and controlling and debriding biofilms.
Yeah, so we're very aggressive. This goes along with the necrotizing fasciitis talks that we had yesterday.
We're very aggressive. We'll generally use a product called Versajet. I don't know if anyone's ever seen that, but it's an excellent debriding device. And we'll debride it down to where it's bleeding and then redress it. We'll generally use negative pressure therapy over those areas. It also is very, very good at controlling the biofilm and then make a determination whether we're going to close it or graft it. But you've got to be very aggressive. I think that the pressure injectors are not very good. I think they get bacteremic from it. And I think you need something that's going to lift the biofilm off. But the biofilm can, you'll start to see the biofilm form in sometimes in an hour, 2 hours it can form. So in those areas where we have very thick biofilm, we'll sometimes take them back to the OR every day to get it debrided until we get it under control to the point where we can get some kind of temporary coverage over it.
Biofilms are awesome. So biofilms are the biofilms I think you're going to find are the source and cause of many of these infections that you can't culture. So one of the things that I would caution you is if the patient looks sick and your cultures are still coming back negative, but things look terrible, then it's probably just because you got to think of the glycocalyx on the biofilm. It's like this massive force field. It's incredible. And so if you're swabbing the top, you're not going to get any of the bacteria, right? They're under this force field. And so there's multiple stages of the biofilm, and when it gets to stage four, it'll embolize and go places. But they're everywhere, right? This is why you have chronic sinusitis. This is, and my hypothesis is why you have higher VAPs, right? We know that you put an endotracheal tube in, and within an hour, some people will have a biofilm on their endotracheal tube. So, and we can talk offline, but that's the one area of research that gets me all jazzed up. So.
Yeah, it's really the key to the whole problem.
Yeah.
And the other thing is that, going back to surgeon versus non-surgeon source control, there are times when that biofilm starts building, you got to take them back every day and get that thing debrided until you get a really good granulation base and get under control. Because otherwise, if it becomes a burden, that's when we get these chronic wounds where people are in wound care centers for 3 and 4 months and they can't get this thing under control because people just miss the basic concept of it.
If I may, Mark, can I ask a question? You talked about percutaneous drainage or source control and length of antibiotics. There was some old data, not very strong, that said if white counts normalized in their AFEB raw for 24 consecutive hours, you can stop antibiotics without recrudescence. Is that what you still read?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, it's just that the only
reason white count that's normal, no fevers, I can stop. I don't need a football. I don't need 10, 14, a touchdown and a field goal worth of antibiotics.
No. The only reason, and at least in my opinion, the only reason to give antibiotics when you percutaneously drain something is because every once in a while you'll see them spike a temperature and their white count will go up a little bit. So I think it's just more for 24-hour prophylaxis. And if their white counts are normal, and remember, it's still going to spill a little bit, but if you get the source control, the antibiotics don't get to it. I mean, that's the point of the talk that I was making is you can give them all the antibiotics you want. If there's no blood supply to something, you can't get antibiotics to it, and there's no blood supply to an abscess. So therefore, why bother and expose them to all the complications?
I like to go end to end and hear everyone's workhorse antimicrobial for the abdomen. We know Dr. Kaplan's is a third generation cephalosporin and an anti-anaerobe. If we could just go end to end, and then I have one more question for Dr. Kaplan. Dr. Wall?
Yeah, probably similar based on whatever the bio thing in the hospital has, and you got to keep checking that because it changes.
Carlos?
We use piperacillin, tazobactam, sozosin is ours. One thing on the length of antibiotics, so the latest Infectious Disease Society of America guidelines for intra-abdominal infection is 4 days of antibiotics after source control. And so I know we can all say 24 hours, 48 hours, 7 days, 10 days. I mean, at least there's some evidence there that you don't need more than 4 days. And so we, even if percutaneous drain of an abscess in the abdomen, we'll do 4 days from source control.
Joe, workhorse.
Yeah, same as actually as Carlos' shop. The unique thing, shock trauma, is we have an ID, a dedicated trauma ID person that rounds with us in ICU. So I'm getting progressively dumber about antibiotics because I have an expert standing next to me. But
so piptazo for you.
Yeah.
Allison?
Zosyn for if they're truly septic with it. And then if it's just like a diverticular abscess, then we'll Rocephin or ertapenem, depending on their allergies.
Lynette?
Based on the antibiogram, ceftriaxone, flagyl in most of our places, really have moved away from Cipro as well, pretty aggressive ID group.
Jay?
Same as the last two panelists.
Yep. David?
Piperacillin, tazobactam, plus or minus vancomycin, and we, just like Carlos said, we use the stop-it trial data, and we do 4 days from source control.
Okay, Piptazo for us. Mark, one last question for you. Given that there's really no strong evidence to support probiotics, how do you justify it?
There's newer data that's coming out. There's at least two prospective studies that have come out recently, one from Hackensack and another one from, I'm not sure where, it's a European study, that has shown like a 20-30% reduction in C. diff. It's very hard to look at prospective trials. The bottom line is it doesn't hurt. But the caveat, there's one caveat, do not use it in immunosuppressed patients because that's where your problem is going to come in. So in our ICU, as soon as they start their tube feeds, we initiate probiotics. We tried to use yogurt, but we weren't getting a good deal in some supermarket, so we had to go to probiotics. But the fact is, I think in the future you're going to find if you support the microbiome, and the only way I know to do it is either with yogurt or probiotics, you will have a tremendous impact, and at least in our institution, since we've been going to this probiotic this protocol, we've had a 40% reduction in C. diff in our ICU. Again, just observational, but I think it really makes a huge difference. I think you've got to support the microbiome. It's something that we don't know about, and again, it sounds like something from GNC or something, but I think that's going to be one of the keys to maintaining these patients in there. It's a lot more important than we realize.
Good. Carlos, perforated foregut, duodenal ulcer, do you add fluconazole, and for how long?
We do use antifungal prophylaxis of the upper GI, either a perforation or an anastomotic leak. The literature was pretty clear on how long, 10 to 14 days when you're treating a fungal infection. However, with prophylaxis, there was no clear guidance as far as how long to prophylax people. So we will probably do it in the same time the antibiotics are going on, so back to the 4 days. But also may try to culture that to see if you're actually treating rather than just prophylaxing. That's a great question. I don't have a really good answer for you as far as how long for prophylaxis.
Yeah, that's
But realize too, the longer you prophylax, that one of the slides that I showed, the more glabrata and parasitosis and other non-albicans species you're going to grow.
So say a patient's really sick, you're looking for trouble, they're just blazing away. You get some sputum that has some fungus in it, or some urine that has some fungus in it. Now you're a little worried. When, if ever, do you use an antifungal there?
I would not treat sputum or urine with an antifungal ever unless there is a deep space infection. So you have an abscess, a fluid collection, close to the respiratory tract, close to the urinary system. Otherwise, I would not treat it in sputum or urine.
Would you use that as a trigger for a more sophisticated test for the presence of fungal infection?
Well, I mean, the beta-D-glucan, which I've never used before, I think to rule it out, if it's negative, you do not have an invasive fungal infection. And again, we're talking about invasive fungal infections. We're not talking about colonization or just the standard ubiquitous candida that's everywhere. But I think one of those other indirect tests is great to rule it out. The problem with beta-D-glucan, like I said, is that it's positive when you don't have an infection, so it can be a little confusing as well.
Candida.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, Alison.
So if you have a patient, they're in the ICU, you do a protective bronch brush or a BAL, it comes back with 20,000 of yeast, and the patient has, still having continued fevers, white counts 15, and they're still doing poorly on the vent. You wouldn't treat that?
I would not treat that. And we also don't do quantitative cultures from a BAL. We do qualitative, and so all I would say is there's candida species. But if it's in the sputum or in the urine, I would not treat it without a deep space infection.
So we take a different effect, right? Because you could see controversy in this, and you'll see treated both ways. But in my eyes, I mean, a true bronch brush or BAL, I mean, that crap shouldn't be down there, right? And so, and if clinically the patient's not doing well, I mean, it's just, and then again, my bias being with the biofilms, right? So you get this biofilm on the endotracheal tube, and you know that a stage 4 biofilm, they just embolize down there. So you got these little like bacteria going, wee, right? So I think you got to look at the whole thing. So maybe, we do treat.
Maybe a good topic for next year's debate. I'm going to move on. Candida auris, should we be scared? Dr. Brown, should we have a plan? The scary new candida. Yes or no?
Which one?
This is the candida auris, this highly resistant candida that we've read about. Should we be scared?
I mean, yeah, I mean, you know, we're going to grow more albicans, non-albicans candida species, and I think there's really, the one study I showed on the table of studies and the most recent literature says echinocandin should be your first line. I think that's the way you deal with that. You start with echinocandins, we use caspofungin, and if once you get your susceptibilities back to that candida, then you can back off to, you know, fluconazole, oral fluconazole if possible. But just start off with a more aggressive stance from the beginning.
Dr. Scherer, ICP monitor, should we change our DVT prophylaxis in those patients? Is that necessary?
Probably not.
How did you develop your DVT algorithm? Could you give us some guidance on how we could write our own DVT prophylaxis guideline that is appropriately progressive and reasonably balanced?
Yeah, you actually don't need to write your own because there's plenty of guidelines published. That's the point, I think. Over the last decade, I think our neurosurgeon colleagues, through some of their own literature, have been able to get more comfortable with turning down the number of days they want to wait. But in many of these head-injured patients, they can start within 24 hours of a stable head CT. In some of the head-injured patients, diffuse axonal injury, there's no reason to wait. Those patients almost never go on to blossom any intracranial hemorrhage. So I think there are some patients that are really easy to get going at 24 hours, but almost all within 24 hours after stable head CT.
Where do
and
we
then
go?
For our standard trauma patients, within 24 hours after hemorrhage is controlled, including solid organ injuries.
Where do we go in our institution to get the data that you described on thrombotic complications that we can then use for our PI?
Well, the beautiful thing with the trauma and the acute care surgery patients is we harbor that data. So all of those complications are discussed at our M&M. We share that at our multidisciplinary rounds. And so all of the liaisons are there, so they get a chance to see that. And if we're really pushing on algorithm development, they'll get that real time so they can discuss it with their group and say, you know, we got another DVT, two in a row.
But your PI program and your trauma program should be picking up your DVTs
correct.
And PEs and if they end up having to have a cranny too. So if you're looking at system-wide or whatever, you should be able to pick it up that way as well.
Dr. DuBose, if we use clinical flail as an indication for chest wall fixation, if we use flail, is that clinical flail or radiographic flail or both?
I think both. I mean, the recognition of this issue has to be done early, and we all see them on the plane films when we see it, right? That you get a chest x-ray and say, whoa, that's a big hole in the fence, right? So you see a lot of those rib abnormalities. I think it has to raise the index of suspicion. Unfortunately, it's hard to, and you can, in a lot of these patients, to see that characteristic movement that you see on some of those old videos on ATLS. For a true clinical flail is problematic, and patients' bobbity habits are different. But if you've got a true flail segment, I think those are patients that probably need to be considered strongly.
I'm going to use that. That's a big hole in the fence.
Yes, sir.
Do you VATS everybody who gets rib fixation? I'm interested in the response of everybody on the panel. Is that a routine, or do you ever fix without a VATS?
We'll fix without a VATS. If there's nothing to drain in there. I mean, Dr. Wall kind of gave us that answer today.
Others on the panel?
I think the pre-op CAT scan is really going to determine what you're going to do. If you just have a contusion, you're just going to plate them. And if you have any evidence of a fluid in there, then you're going to VATS them and also do the fixation at the same time.
Yeah, we don't necessarily VATS with all the fixations. One thing on the flail, though, there's plenty of patients that have a radiographic flail that looked perfect. Yep. That are on the floor pulling 3,000 on their IS, they don't need a rib fixation, right? You need to have the other things going on. The other thing, too, is if you have a huge underlying pulmonary contusion, that's going to drive their outcome far more than the flail, and that would be, like was mentioned, you know, relative contraindication to that. So I think kind of putting a broad blanket out there saying anyone with a flail gets a fixation doesn't make sense. But the clinical flail, the real flail with, you know, with the paradoxical respirations and all that, those patients, I think, pretty clearly benefit from the limited literature.
Dr. Johannigman, lots of questions on complex ventilation and proning. Can you prone patients with open abdomens?
Yeah, we actually do. Whether they have an open abdomen or not, you know, I advocated just throwing them upside down on pillows. One of the keys to proning appropriately is to make sure that you do it vertically along the axilla so that the abdomen is actually floating free and is dependent, because that's another reason prone works, is you get the abdomen and the diaphragms more fully recruited. But yes, we've had experience both in theater. In fact, I think we did one in theater with you, David, that we'll go ahead and prone an open abdomen. And you know, cervical spine immobility is not an absolute contraindication. You do need to be very careful whether it's 4 hours or 16 hours. The biggest problem we've seen with prone is pressure decubiti, especially about the face and the endotracheal tubes and the nasogastric tubes. And the only thing that worries me, Gadeoni's paper used 16 hours. That's true. I probably wouldn't advocate that in my unit. I'd probably advocate 8 hours or with a turn, at least 30 minutes, long enough to get your personnel in there, readjust all your padding, and then go back and continue proning. But those are the biggest problems we've seen.
So talk about manual proning. Do you have to have the bed? Obviously, the answer is no.
Correct.
Do you prone with a bed at your place, or do you manual prone without the bed?
The biggest thing, if you want to do this, is you need people. It's really people power. You need to get everybody over freaking out about proning the patient. So it works best to have a team that is nursing staff, critical. You know, when we first do it, we always have an ICU doc there and a respiratory therapist. And there's actually a couple of very good YouTube videos out there that show you how to use just a team of manpower and prone somebody. Once you get everybody over the anxiety and they see the results of proning, which are almost always, if you do it early enough, it's almost always it works quite successfully and keeps me from having to get Dr. Zonies up in the middle of the night.
Dr. Wall, lots of questions about hemothoraces. How big, let's start with how big a hemothorax needs to be drained, and then what sort of tube do you use to drain it? Do you use a pigtail or small 14 French tube, or are you still using big tubes?
You know, usually you get the plain film, and if it's anything more and obscure in the diaphragm, that's about 500 cc's, you're typically going to address it. You know, originally we were putting 36 French chest tubes, because originally we had a study that said we put the small tubes in, it didn't work, but actually there's more and more data that people are using pigtails. I'm trying to learn from that. I'm still a little skeptical, but I'm watching it and see. I personally still like big tubes, but watching it.
Last question, who should evacuate clotted hemothoraces and fibrothoraces by VATS, and is that surgeon population different if it's going to be thoracotomy? Trauma surgeons, thoracic surgeons, does it matter who's better?
You know, I think, you know, who's ever qualified and can do it well, and you track their quality, ought to be able to do it. I mean, that's a general surgical case. Now, the realistic part of it is there's a group of folks that don't have a lot of thoracic experience and aren't comfortable doing a decortication, so you just got to know what your own capabilities are.
Can I hear from the rest of the panel here before we close, who does the VATS and thoracotomies for decortication at your place in the trauma population?
We do both trauma and non-trauma VATS.
Yeah, the same as shock trauma.
Same for us.
For the trauma patients, particularly if it's just in that early phase and it's going to be limited and we know it's still liquid, then the trauma folks will oftentimes do it. Many of our thoracics people, to be quite honest, aren't comfortable with the trauma patient, to be quite honest. When it gets to the point where it's truly a decortication, they'll do that, but it oftentimes takes a lot of encouragement from us to get them to do that. They're much more comfortable with the robot and doing robotic lobes now, to be honest.
Dr. Scherer?
We don't do a lot of VATS, but when we do, it's generally thoracic.
Jay?
We do our VATS, and then on the occasion we need decortication, we at least let thoracic know we're going to be in the operating room.
Dr. Zonies?
Early VATS, the trauma surgeons will do it. If it looks complex, we have a good working relationship with thoracics, and they usually will take on the more complex cases.
This was a long session, but really, really outstanding. I want to thank the audience for their patience and an outstanding group of presenters. We're adjourned until 10:30.
You can be the outcast, be the backlash of somebody's lack of love.